Welcome to another exciting broadcast of USLIA Lacrosse. Tonight we bring you the RMILL Championship game featuring the number 2 ranked Brigham Young University Cougars versus the number 4 ranked Colorado State Rams. Hi, I'm Marty Westcott, and welcome once again to Southfield on the campus of Brigham Young University. We're coming to you live nationally on BYU TV and locally on KBYU TV Channel 11. Joining me in the booth, as always, is BYU Lacrosse Hall of Famer Charlie Friedman. And Charlie, it rained all day here in Provo. The sun came out about an hour ago. Conditions look great. And it worked out really well in the brackets as well. Number 1 versus number 2 meeting each other. Number 2 versus number 4 in the country. It's a great game.
It almost didn't happen that way. Colorado was game yesterday. They had a terrific output against Colorado State. But Colorado State, the champions that they are, were able to come up in the last 5 minutes, tie the game, take the lead, and finish it out.
And that was a very exciting game with CSU and CU last night. We hope to match that intensity with tonight's game. Tonight's game features some of the top attack squads in the country. That starts at CSU with Mike Napolilli and Ryan Davis.
Mike Napolilli and Ryan Davis are a terrific unit. Ryan Davis, MVP of the USLIA National Championship Tournament, where Colorado State were the national champions. Mike Napolilli is a big guy. He's got a great shot. He loves to control the action, and he'll draw a lot of attention from the Cougar defensemen.
And that was a concern of Coach Lamb coming into this game, is the Cougar defense handling these tough attacking for CSU. On the BYU side, you're talking about the vaunted attack we've seen all year, Jordan Archibald and Rex Hardy.
You know, one thing comes to mind when you talk about Jordan Archibald and Rex Hardy, and that's chemistry. These guys have played together for so long. They played in high school together. They're talented players. Rex Hardy draws so much attention from the defense, draws double teams, triple teams. Jordan finds himself open, and he knows what to do when he gets the ball on his stick.
And one thing that we really noticed last night as they were playing Utah, these guys are big. The defensemen have to come in with more than just a stick check to take the ball away from them. I'll tell you, we've got more than going on than just the matchups on the field. These teams hate each other. They played each other a number of times over the last couple of years. For more on this rivalry, let's go to the sideline and Rand Champion.
You know, when you talk about rivalries, this is as good as it gets. These are the two premier teams of this league. Because of that, they developed a very heated rivalry between the two. This is also the fifth year in a row they faced each other in the championship game, with each team having won twice before. But not only is this just a championship game, the winner of this gets a higher seeding when nationals start on May 8th. So Marty and Charlie, the way they've been playing lately, this may not be the last time these two teams face each other.
And Charlie, talking to both of these coaches before the game here, they expect to see each other again before the season's over. So we not only are going to bring you the RMILL Championship game, but there's more riding on this game with nationals waiting in the wings in St. Louis. We're going to be right back with today's starting lineups in just a moment.
Are you serious about improving your game? Then come learn from the best. BYU Sports Camps offer expert instruction from the coaches, players, and staff who won a combined 7 NCAA championships and over 235 conference titles. With 40 different camps for youth of all ages and abilities, we'll help you take your game to the next level. Sign up now.
And Alex Smith in the goal, a fantastic goalie.
So much they could be achieving. Kids with learning disabilities are smart. They just learn differently. Call or visit us on the web now.
Welcome back to our broadcast of the RMILL Championship game. The teams have just been introduced, and both these teams are fired up, Charlie. Let's take a look at their starters.
Here's the Colorado State starters, and these are all very familiar names. Napolili, Davis, Harper, Preby, Hassan, Hammond, Smith. It's a terrific midfield unit, and there's one midfielder on the list that we haven't discussed, and that's Tim Farquhar, who is a rising star in this league. Here's the defense. It's a great unit. Schmidt, Tabachi, Price, and Alex Smith in the goal. A fantastic goalie. Notably absent from that list is Mike Plonky, who was unable to be at the tournament due to a wedding in the family. And congratulations to Mike on that. Coach Flip Nomberg, a class act, a great lacrosse mind, and always has this team prepared.
And on the BYU side of things, the starters, of course, are going to start with that attack of Hardy, Archibald, and Lee.
Hardy, Archibald, and Lee is a great unit. Rupert Peel, Cohn, and Jeff Jackson, who is really a terrific long stick middie here. And Aaron Quiggle, young Brian Kubesch, got their work cut out for him today with this great Colorado State attack group.
And really the key to this game, I think, tonight is going to be, there's Coach Lamb. Before we jump into that, you know, we've mentioned his resume before, USLIA president, and has really led this BYU program into national prominence in a record of 123-30 in his eighth season. Coach Lamb, a fantastic job here with the Cougar program. And yeah, as we were mentioning before, the BYU defense, being able to hold that vaunted CSU attack in check tonight is going to be key for the Cougars.
There's so many interesting matchups. The BYU defense, that great attack line, that great Colorado State attack line, it's really going to be interesting to see how this thing plays out. But watch number 13, Tim Farquhar, on the midfield line for Colorado State. He's a real key to this game if the Cougars can control him.
And he was facing off against Dave Rueckert. Dave Rueckert, a new face-off element for the Cougars, and wins the face-off against Farquhar. He's going up against Farquhar, going right to the right-hand sweep, moving to the left, going to take a left-handed shot. Alex Smith with the save for CSU. A nice shot, nice move, right off the face-off.
Yeah, Cougars looking to press the action. In fact, both of these teams are real run-and-gun teams. It should be exciting action here tonight.
Jared Katz now handling for the Rams up against Jordan Peel. Tries to get it up to number 16. Ryan Davis goes off his stick. And Napalili comes up with that. Number two is Stanitz Harper for the Rams, and he's the third attackman. CSU settling it down a little bit. Trying to get it around. Napalili losing it. Brian Kubesch now coming up for the Cougars. Trying to clear, but Napalili goes over his head, checks it out of his stick. It's going to go back to the Rams.
Heads up play by Napalili there.
So the Rams trying to get into their offensive set, work the ball around. We saw yesterday they were able to work the ball patiently and really come back against CU at the end of the game. And looking to do that really to start off here today.
You know, they're a team that plays off of emotion. They can get really hot out there and very excited, which can help them really explode and score in bunches. But they also have to keep that in check. If you play too much out of control, of course, it will damage your effort.
Randall Cohn now for the Cougars, bringing it down on a fast break opportunity. Sees Lee on the crease, overthrows him. Cougars miss a perfect opportunity there. Mike Lee was standing wide open on the crease, and Cohn unable to get it to him.
Not a very good omen for the Cougars there. In this kind of game, when you get opportunities, you have to capitalize.
Two opportunities for the Cougars now, unable to execute. And now clearing for CSU. And there's number nine. That's Katz. Going around, there's Stanis Harper taking a shot at McKechnie. Goes wide, Ryan Davis backs it up.
That's nice work by McKechnie. He's got really quick hands. He's able to get a stick in front of that shot.
We go ahead and see this shot here. Coming from Katz, Stanis Harper just goes wide to the right. McKechnie seemed to have a good beat on it, though. And we've got some substitutions here. A dead ball situation, so they're allowing him to substitute. Farquhar, the midfielder, is in there. He's got a defensive midi specialist, Mo Poole, who's going to just check him the whole game. Now Kubesch against Napalili. Stanis Harper with the skip pass. Jeff Jackson with the short stick out there, Charlie.
Wow, that is unusual.
Jeff Jackson normally
coaches thinking there, putting him out there with the short stick.
A few wrinkles here for the Cougars. Jeff Jackson out there with the short pole, going against an attackman. And it's Harper. So there's Farquhar going against Mo Poole, defensive specialist. Number 25, John Knapp, handling for the Rams. And he's going against Taylor Cotterill. And Jimmy Young now facing up against Ryan Davis. And Jason Hunt missing that ball. Jason Hunt also in there with the long stick. And Poole trying to pick up the ground ball, getting hounded there by a couple of Rams. Napalili. And we've got a loose ball push on the Rams. It's going to go to BYU. Rex Hardy's going to handle it here for the Cougars. A couple of different wrinkles we've seen on the defensive end so far, Charlie, with a couple of long stick midfielders and defenders switching positions.
Yeah, I think both coaches with a little gamesmanship here. There you saw the push where the Colorado State player clearly took his hand off the stick and pushed Cougar Mo Poole in the back there. And see what the Cougars can do on this offensive side.
So here's Mike Lee handling it behind over to Jordan Archibald, up to Randall Cohn. Unable to handle it. Randall Cohn with the face dodge. Gets stripped there by Jim Hassan, number 21. Hassan getting hounded there by Hardy. Number 29 now handling it. Jeremy Smith for the Rams. Over to Cale Nelson. Big midfielder for the Rams. Cale Nelson, number one, going up against Jordan Peele. Looks at Napa Lilly, gets it number 21. That was Jim Hassan on the goal. So the Rams go up to the early lead, 1-0.
And terrific offensive sequence for Colorado State. But I'm impressed right now with their defense. They've handled everything that the Cougars have been able to throw at them.
You can take another look at this goal. Hassan just on the crease. Obviously a missed assignment there for that man to get open. So Hassan, number 21, scoring for the Rams, putting them up with about 11 minutes left here in the first quarter, 1-0. So the Cougars have had a couple of opportunities, unable to take advantage, and the Rams get an opportunity and put it in.
And that is a very frustrating missed assignment for the defense. Cardinal rule is when your player is on the crease, you have to front him. You have to shut him off. He's such a scoring threat, and there wasn't a defenseman to be found near there.
So Phil McClure now coming up with the faceoff for the Cougars. So the Cougars winning two faceoffs. Tim Farquhar for CSU is going to come up with a push in the back. He's going to get a minute for an illegal body check. It looks like it's a technical foul. Going to get 30 seconds, but the Cougars are going to be man up here for 30 seconds.
This is a chance for the Cougars to settle down and tie this thing up, get a little momentum on their side, let their offense work nicely.
But something that we talked about in last night's game, faceoffs being an important part of the Cougars' overall scheme, and they've got to get possession. So far, doing a pretty good job tonight.
Yeah, I think Dave Rucker, who I think has taken all the faces so far tonight, seems to be doing a really nice job. He's able to use that big frame and the leverage that he can generate, and he seems to be doing a nice job there on the faces. That'd be a nice question answered for the Cougars.
So here come the Cougars. They take a little while to get into their man-up rotation, it seems. They're just working it patiently around, waiting for that defense to rotate into a position where they have an open man. We saw it last night with Rex Hardy coming open on this wing right there. CSU's got it covered. A skip pass to Dave Rucker up the middle. Jordan Peele covers it. Now Randall Cohn settling it down. Man coming on for CSU. We've got an even situation. We have equal players on the field. Hardy's going to take his man. Sees Mike Lee on the crease again, unable to get it to him. And we're going to have Mike Lee in the crease. Oh, we're going to have a push. So CSU must have pushed him in the crease. Got a loose ball situation. It's going to be a push, go possession, BYU.
I love seeing Rex Hardy roll dodge right at the side of the cage. He plants his foot really hard, and he generates a lot of energy on that roll dodge. He usually loses his defenseman. I think it's a weapon that he can take advantage of tonight.
Well, Dave Rucker now up top. Cougars going into their 1-4-1 set. Out to Randall Cohn. Back to Hardy. Hardy going up against Jeff Schmidt tonight. Big defender, number 37. Up to Dave Rucker. He's going against Cale Nelson. Nelson trying to force him to the left. But again, we've seen Rucker can score with the left. I don't know if that's such a wise move. Pops Alex Smith right in the mouth with that shot. Coming up with his cats for CSU. And we've got a loose ball push on CSU again. Possession going to go to BYU.
You know, there used to be a school of lacrosse where an attackman would fire his first shot directly at the defenseman covering him, and the second shot directly at the face of the goalie. Now, I'm not endorsing that, but that strategy was aimed at rattling the defenders in this case. And that shot may have had that effect. That nailed Alex Smith right in the cage.
But again, if CSU is going to make Dave Rucker go to the left, that's BYU will take that. As you can see, Dave Rucker can take a nice left-handed shot. So Dave Rucker now handling it for the Cougars. Over on the side, going against Cale Nelson. Sweeping to the right, muscling through a couple of guys. Schmidt sliding onto him, now covering him. So Hardy's going to have a different man. I think Hardy's got a problem with his stick. Coming over, switching sticks on the sideline. Jordan Archibald settling it down. So the Cougars settling it down while Hardy gets his stick situation cleared up. Joe Glashinsky going against Archibald. Archibald just forcing that one in there, unable to put it by Alex Smith.
Cougars generating a lot of shots, but they need to make good decisions on their shots. Taking nothing away from Alex Smith, who seems to be having a pretty good game so far.
Jimmy Young coming up with that loose ball. Getting into Cale Nelson.
Uh-oh.
Bad situation for the Cougars, and CSU comes up with a goal. Stanitz Harper scoring the goal. They just had a numbers game right there, and CSU able to capitalize.
It's a tale of the defenses for me right now, and BYU's defense has got to get in the game. They're missing assignments. They're making mental mistakes. CSU's defense is right in this game. They're sharp. They're where they need to be. Their slides are terrific.
McKechnie made the right play there. He really didn't have a choice. He had to come out and challenge that shot. But that's tough for any defense or any goalie one-on-one with nobody in the vicinity. So we just had a couple of missed assignments for BYU so far.
Really, McKechnie's best hope was probably to level the CSU attackman in that case. He just couldn't get there fast enough.
So we've got some new faces. Mike Spencer and Phil Eichhorn facing off. Mike Spencer for the Cougars and Phil Eichhorn for CSU. Mike Lee now over to Jordan Archibald. Over to Hardy.
I'm pretty concerned about Hardy's stick change. People get very attached, the lacrosse players get very attached to their sticks, and when they have to switch at a critical time in a game, like right now, I'm really worried that he's comfortable with his second stick.
So we've got Mike Lee now controlling behind. Up to Brian Haslam. Moving behind. Getting it to Rex Hardy again, going to get Schmidt, number 37 for CSU. One person you might notice on the field here, Charlie, number 6, Chris Rucker. He's been injured for about a month. Injured his ankle in the CU game about a month ago. This is the first action he's seen, and it doesn't look to be moving very well out there. Referee should have had a play-on situation there. He realized it, but blew the whistle, had to keep going. So Hugh West now controlling for the Cougars, number 26. That was CSU offsides, and so it should have gone to BYU, but... inadvertent whistle. So Jordan Archibald now against Glashinsky.
Oh, great shot by Jordan.
It's a nice shot. Just a little bit wide. So Glashinsky doing a nice job on Archibald so far. And Schmidt, big defender, able to handle the size of Hardy. And Jordan Archibald, you can take a look in the lax window. Archibald's last shot. Tries to feed to Hardy on the crease. Gets it. Wings it wide. It's going to go to BYU.
Hardy just didn't plant his foot on that shot like he needed to, and that's why it went wide.
Probably didn't feel he had enough time there with Jeff Schmidt right in his hip pocket. Hugh West now up to Chris Rueckert. Younger brother of Dave Rueckert, again, has been injured, and good to see him back in the lineup.
It's a welcome sight for the Cougars to see him back in here tonight.
So here's Chris Rueckert handling up top, going against Cale Nelson. Rueckert, little worm burner. Alex Smith able to get on top of it.
Alex Smith came to play tonight. He's really filling up the cage nicely.
Phil Eichhorn clearing for the Rams. Gets it up to number 33, Ryan Price. You can see that last save in the lax window there by Smith. A nice save. And Nelson up to Farquhar. Farquhar defended there by Haslam. That's probably a mismatch for the Cougars, but the Cougars luck out. The Rams did not get it into the restraining box in the 10-second time limit, so they turned the ball over.
Yeah, that's one of those mental mistakes, and boy, that's a frustrating way to lose a possession.
And I'll tell you, they had a mismatch there. Farquhar, we saw yesterday, just ate CU alive, and the Cougars concerned about him. Had Brian Haslam covering him, and probably could have taken advantage of that a little bit. Hugh West just getting checked, getting his stick just checked right out of his hand. Here comes Farquhar. You can see his skills coming up the field here. Cougars challenging him at the midfield. Has him on him again. He's got a nice right-handed shot. There it is. McKechnie with a nice save. Clearing now for the Cougars. So McKechnie with a nice save on that one.
McKechnie with a nice save, and Farquhar running through four Cougars on that shot. The guy has skills.
It's that right-handed shot that I think Lamb is really concerned about. It looks like Rex Hardy has switched his stick once again, whether he went back to the... we've got a push from behind. That's going to be on Jared Katz for CSU. And just push him in the back. So we're going to illegal body check. Looks like a technical 30-second penalty. BYU is going to be man up again. Another opportunity they got to take advantage of.
They are getting their opportunities and need to start capitalizing on these chances. Here's another terrific chance.
So you mentioned that stick problem with Hardy. Whether or not they fixed his other stick or what's going on, but he's changed them twice. And we've got the man-up unit for BYU. Dave Rueckert up top. Over to Randall Cohn. Hardy, there's the open wing. Just gets it right by Alex Smith. Had it stick side. Smith had a beat on it. Just beat him.
Yeah, that's one of those things where had the goalie just relaxed and left the stick where it was, he would have made the save.
But you can see you'll see on this replay here, they move the ball around. They get this man open, curling around. Stick side just beats it.
Yeah.
Just just plain out beat him. So a lot of times you'll see the shooter want to get an off stick side, but Hardy just blows it by him on that one.
And that's exactly the way that Coach Lamb drew up his man-up offense. A lot of rotation, find the open man with a good position on the cage, and finish with the shot.
And you get dumb commentators like us that think you don't know what he's doing. He knows exactly what he's doing out there. He's lulling us all to sleep. Hardy sneaks around the outside, scores a goal.
Well, I think the defender, Schmidt, is having as good a night so far as I've seen any defender have on Rex Hardy. I think he's got some terrific skills. That's one of those matchups that I'm concentrating on today. It's a good one.
The Cougars winning another faceoff, so that's got to be encouraging for Coach Lamb. Getting the possession, getting the opportunities, they've got to capitalize at this point. So we're going to see Jordan Peelhill now just bring it around, invert with the midi behind, and they're going to do this with Rukert and Peel, and we're seeing Cone go down to the crease as well. So they have a complete inverted offense set up now with midfielders behind, attackmen up top.
They're taking that 1-4-1 instead of running it from the top of the cage, they're running it from behind.
And Rukert trying to take it to the cage, gets forced into the crease and turns it over. So probably not the wisest move there, but I think that's going to be an interesting wrinkle we'll probably see again.
And something it looks like the Coach Lamb put in for this game, is it something that you've seen before this game?
I have not seen that, and I think I bet we'll see it again, and probably to take advantage of the attack presence up top. So here's Stannis Harper with another shot, and gets it by wide. Jimmy Young racing Ryan Davis to the end line. Ryan Davis wins that battle, so it goes to CSU. Penalty is Napa Lily going against Jason Hunt. Now you see Jason Hunt in there on the defensive end of things. We're going to see Aaron Quiggle matching up against Farquhar, I think, on the midfield line.
And I think that's why we haven't called Farquhar's number quite as much as I expected so far.
Napa Lily.
Great save by McKechnie.
Napa Lily coming in, paying the price. And we've got double penalties on Napa Lily and Charles Kikimoto. Little action after the ball gets knocked out of there. I think the referees just wanted to get control of this thing right up front. Aaron Quiggle knocking Napa Lily right down, making a pay for the shot. Napa Lily coming up, hitting Kikimoto. Kikimoto responds. Both get penalties, so we're going to be in a 5-on-5 situation.
This is a physical game, and you know, you hate to see double penalties and people getting a little too hot, but in an important game like this, both teams know what's at stake. They're willing to bring out the physical play to come home with the win.
Coach, I just saw Coach Nomberg kind of in jest with Coach Lamb going, well, that was kind of stupid, and they both kind of shook their heads and said yes. But I think the referees really just are maybe a little bit oversensitive, trying to get things under control quickly in this game.
I'm with referee Hank Friedman in that case. I think that was a good call. Clearly action was going on after the play was blown dead, and I think he did the right thing.
So we are going to be, each team will be a man down. For 1 minute, each team will be a man down for a minute. So we're still at even strength, just at 5-on-5 rather than 6-on-6. And again, the referee's getting a handle on this game quickly, certainly understanding the rivalry that exists.
This is going to be very interesting. You have less guys on the field. You have wider lanes for cutters to run in. I'm not sure right now whose advantage this is going to play into. Maybe Colorado State's, because they have such a great slashing game, there's just more room on the field.
Cale Nelson going to the right, gets checked there by Mo Poole with a nice check. Mo Poole picks up the ground ball, and we're going to get a moving pick on BYU. So once Mo Poole picked up that ball, we had somebody make contact with the CSU player, they called a penalty. It's interesting to watch Napa Lily and Kikimoto. They played against each other in high school, and they're the ones that were involved in the little extracurricular. Both played at Eagle Crest and Cherry Creek High School, respectively, in Colorado. So they all, a lot of friends are going against each other.
Yeah, in fact, Kikimoto is a transfer from Colorado State. He knows most of the guys on the team.
Oh, and there's a nice play.
Terrific play.
Stannis Harper to number 12, Doug Preby. And just puts it off stick side of McKechnie. Right over his shoulder. Let me take another look at it right here. With the assist, just off stick side, right over his shoulder. That's a tough one for any goalie to save. But
again, I don't understand how a Colorado State attackman, or any attackman for that matter, can get so close to the crease, loses defensemen so completely in that case. And the BYU defense has had a problem with that on all three of the Colorado State goals. They've really got to keep track of their attackmen. Those attackmen are wily out there. They're finding a way to get into open space.
So with 3:47 left in the first quarter, the visiting and number two rated in the RMILL, CSU Rams leading BYU 3-1. facing off. Mike Spencer for the Cougars, winning another faceoff. They've got to be pleased with that. He was going against the long stick, number four, Joe Glashinsky. And now we're back to the attack here for BYU. Mike Lee going against number 33, Ryan Price. And Archibald now settling it up. The Cougars getting some substitutions in here. Certainly want to answer this goal back, get it to a one-goal game. Jordan Peel handling for the Cougars, number two. And the penalties have been released, so we are at even strength with both teams. A six-on-six scenario. Up top to Randall Cohn for the Cougars, going against Cale Nelson. Jordan Peel against Katz for CSU. And again, we're seeing that inverted offense again, where the midfielder is going behind. And it looks like CSU is countering with a zone defense. They're not challenging those BYU attackmen behind.
It's a very interesting move. Probably a good one by Coach Nomberg.
I think what we're going to see here is the attackmen now for BYU who are playing up at the top of the field are going to go against the short midfielders of CSU. Mike Lee with a nice little look to Dave Ruckert. And it's you see both teams seem to be a little bit uneasy because they're not familiar positions. So it's kind of interesting to watch this offense develop.
But here we got Rex Hardy on a short stick. And oh, my goodness, and a terrific hit.
And you're not going to see that very often. You're not going to see that very often. Rex Hardy looked to fake Jared Katz with a very well-timed hit. And the penalty comes because Hardy was on the ground.
I thought I heard a little helmet in there, too. But look at that hit. That's great lacrosse. I take my hat off to that one. That was a great open field hit. Boy, CSU is really excited right now. They've earned it. They're playing a terrific game so far.
But you saw Hardy. This is a perfectly timed hit here. He's trying to cross over right in front of Katz. Katz catches him. Boom. And while he's on the ground right here, boom, right on the head. And that's what they call the penalty. And he got a head on that. They got two penalties on the head, but they only called the one. But Glashinsky got him on the way up as well. So BYU's in a man-up situation again. And pressuring is CSU. So they're out-pressuring, which is characteristic of BYU's man-down defense. And there's Archibald. He's got that shot. Hardy now trying to pick it up against Schmidt. And the attacking for BYU fighting for it, unable to come up with it. And now the CSU Rams are clearing the other way.
This is where Jared they're dangerous. Katz. They're so dangerous in this transition.
And the midfielders for BYU have got to cut that off. They do a good job. But you had a BYU midfielder up against Stannis Harper, who's an attacker for CSU. They tried to take advantage of that mismatch right away. They've still got it. You've got number two, Stannis Harper. Stannis Harper taking it against Randall Cohn, scoring a goal. So during the replay, Stannis Harper saw they had a short stick on him, took him to the cage, and that's his second goal of the night, if I recall. You can see now, we're going to see the goal here on the replay. But Stannis Harper, number two, just putting it by McKechnie. Beat him close post. Cardinals in for the goalie. Can't let it go close post.
You know, CSU is coming out with so much energy. They obviously were ready to play this game. BYU went into Colorado State's territory at Hughes Stadium in front of 5,000 people and defeated the Rams 17-10. And I think that has been grating on the Rams. They came out with a lot of energy and determination to. I'm sure they've had this game marked on their calendar for a long time. They're playing with a lot of confidence. They just look great tonight.
BYU winning another faceoff. Settling it down here is Hardy. BYU's had their opportunity. They just haven't been able to capitalize.
Well, they are getting their chances. They're winning the faceoffs. They're winning the battle of possessions. But they're just not converting. And Colorado State looks so good in those unsettled situations. When they get the ball, they're capitalized.
And they're taking advantage of the missed matchups that BYU's given them on the defensive end. So BYU now looking to get another opportunity here with 44 seconds left in the first half. Hugh West, freshman, coming out with the left hand. Gets it over to Archibald, over to Mike Lee. Gets up to Chris Ruckert. Chris Ruckert going against the long stick there, number 35, Nick Tabachi. Hugh West to Archibald. Got about 27 seconds left in the quarter. Hardy's going to go. Not a lot of time left. Give it to your main man, let him make a move. Alex Smith eats it up. For Schmidt, clearing for the Rams, gets up to Farquhar. Like you said, he hasn't been a factor so far today, but there he goes against Chris Ruckert. And a nice little right-handed shot. McKechnie saves it. Nice save. And there's the quarter. And there's a little extra
activity after.
A little extracurricular. Gobbled up there quickly by Hank Friedman, the referee. Does a nice job stopping that. We've got a, I believe Rand Champion has some information on the troubles Rex Hardy's had with his stick. Rand?
All right, you saw him earlier working on Rex Hardy's stick. What happened, the back part here, which cradles the ball, but when netting had come loose, making the ball either stick or slide right through back there. So the trainer grabbed it, just grabbed some string, tied it up, and Marty, it's nothing impressive, nothing fancy, but at this stage of the game, you just kind of do what you need to do.
Well, like Charlie, you mentioned, these guys, they get attached to their sticks, and you know, you've played, and you know, to play with a different stick can really throw your game off.
That stick in this game just becomes an extension of your arms and your shoulders, and you get so comfortable with it. Switching sticks is a very difficult thing to do, but I've been watching it, and it doesn't seem to have bothered Hardy very much. His game doesn't seem to have changed.
I think the thing that's really bothered them is the nice defensive play that CSU has had so far. You can see here a little bit of the, this was a little extracurricular here at the end of the quarter, and that little push there, Jimmy Young responds a little bit, and they both smart enough to hold up. Kubesh with the cool head in there, make sure that nothing happens, and then the referee was one step behind. So
you know, that's a very interesting no call, and I think most referees would have called Jimmy Young in that situation.
He has a reputation and gets quite a bit of those. So here's our Cougar Club first quarter stats. Take a look there, Charlie. The ground balls in BYU's favor.
Yeah, ground balls in BYU's favor. Actually, I'm surprised that CSU has more shots ahead. It seems like the Cougars have had more shots on goal, but not the case.
And you can look at that last stat there, 6 faceoffs to 0.
That's staggering.
And that's going to be huge for the Cougars. If they can continue to win faceoffs, they've got a real good opportunity to win this game. They just got to capitalize on those opportunities.
And yet, if you had told me that the Cougars would be up 6-0 on faceoffs after the first quarter, I never would have guessed Colorado State would be ahead 4-1 in the score.
And here you go. Here's Dave Rueckert winning that faceoff. Going to the left. Jared Katz able to just affect his direction enough that he couldn't make that pass over the attacker. So we get a settled situation now. Jordan Archibald settling for the Cougars as midfielders come in. But that's 7 faceoffs now.
I think the Cougars have found something in their faceoffs. It's really impressive.
Jordan Peele back to Mike Lee. That first unit on for the Cougars. Really need a goal here in this possession to kind of swing the tide here, the momentum. Mike Lee handling it for the Cougars behind. Sees an opportunity, trying to go on his man, Price. Jordan Archibald sees a man on the crease. Dave Rueckert was cutting, unable to get it to him. Jordan Peele coming up with the ground ball. And Jared Katz for CSU in the vicinity. And there's Mike Lee. Going to settle it down a little bit. Sees an opportunity to go on his man, Price now. Guarding Archibald. Randall Cohn over to Dave Rueckert. Rueckert defended there by Phil Eichhorn, number 19 for the Rams.
CSU is playing great team defense, and I'll tell you how you know, there just aren't a lot of opportunities out there.
And here BYU goes into their 1-4-1 offense. Jordan Peele to the left. Archibald to Hardy, looking for opportunities, cutters. Rueckert up at the top. You can see a shot here, and there's a shot and a goal, but we've got a flag before the shot. And let's see what the referees are going to call here.
Got to be on the Cougars, or else the play wouldn't have discontinued.
Well, the referees threw a flag, and that would normally indicate a penalty on the defense. So let's see what they call
here.
But
they wouldn't stop the play unless the ball hit the ground, which it did not.
That's a good point. So we got a little confusion out here. But it looks like it is going to be on CSU. But again, why would the referee stop play there?
I think that's a technical mistake by the referees, and I think it's a very costly one in what is going to be probably a very tight game.
Because that was a goal by Dave Rueckert.
Who knows, maybe some of the CSU players stopped in that situation reacting to the whistle because Rueckert scored right as the whistle was blowing. But, yeah, I think that was a mechanics mistake by the referees.
Flag down situation should have been a play on, giving the Cougars a scoring opportunity. Jordan Peele with the shot, but Alex Smith with a beat on it.
Alex Smith playing a really nice game right now.
It looks like your best opportunity to beat Smith in the goal is going to be with the bounce shot. He's really stopped those high shots. Uh-oh, we got a one-on-one again. And McKechnie comes up huge against Ryan Davis. That was huge by McKechnie.
That's good position by McKechnie, but that's also just a flat-out missed shot. But McKechnie clearly contributed to the errant shot.
That was the last shot there on the replay by Jordan Peele. But that last play, CSU could have gone up 5-1. Huge momentum, and McKechnie stuffed him. So let's see if BYU can now capitalize on that huge save, see if they can get an opportunity here. We've got an even situation now. CSU bringing their man back on. Hardy looking for the cross pass to Archibald. All the way across the crease, pretty risky, but able to get it through there. Archibald being handled there by Joe Glashinsky. Now he's going to go to the cage. Drops the ball. And who we got there? Again, CSU with the push. Loose ball going to BYU.
The battle of possessions is clearly in BYU's favor, but they have not been able to capitalize with golden opportunities.
He drops the ball right here, and there's the push. They get the playoff situation, so as soon as he picks it up, they call it for BYU. So CSU didn't seem to agree with that call. Maybe a little touch call, but BYU's ball nonetheless. Jordan Peele up top, 1-for-1 offense going to the right. Outlet pass to Hardy, back to Lee. They got to keep moving the ball around. There goes to Archibald. He sees an opening. Shot on Smith, just goes wide. So Hardy now taking it behind for the Cougars. You can see this shot here coming up in the lax window. Archibald just wide again. Smith right on it.
And the CSU bench chanting CSU. I can tell you the momentum is all CSU right now.
Jordan Peele back to Hardy. Hardy, see if he can take things into his own hand. Schmidt, big boy, able to handle Hardy physically. But Hardy with a nice move. Just turned Schmidt around and with a nice underhanded shot. I don't think Alex Smith expected that at all.
And Schmidt shrugs his shoulders. I'll tell you, I think Schmidt is a nice defenseman. I haven't heard his name very much. I think he's playing great. Rex just got a little bit of separation there. Not much separation.
Enough separation to use Schmidt as a screen.
Yeah, use him as a screen.
Alex Smith didn't know this was coming until it was in the goal.
Unbelievable. Rex Hardy can do some magical things out there. That was really impressive.
So he really just used Schmidt against himself and was able to, if you can do that, can you use yourself against yourself? But
I think he just did.
Rex Hardy can do it. I certainly couldn't, but it was a nice shot there on Alex Smith. So the Cougars, again, started really with that save with McKechnie. It would have been 5-1. Now it's 4-2. And the Cougars winning another faceoff. We got a timeout for the Cougars. So I think Coach Lamb, seeing they've got some momentum going their way, trying to set up a play to get another offensive opportunity here.
And as advertised, we've got a great lacrosse game tonight.
But it's fantastic. I think that save by McKechnie, for at least the second quarter, could be a turning point in the second quarter.
It seems to have been a momentum changer, and Rex Hardy's goal, which was so impressive. That really could fire up the Cougars on the sidelines.
So you can see the Cougars there talking with Coach Lamb during this timeout. I think Coach Lamb sensed that we've got the, BYU has the ball. There's an opportunity to put another goal on the board here and wants to make sure they take full advantage of this opportunity because that's what their problem's been. Like you said, they're winning the possession battle, but just not capitalizing.
And Coach Chris Rader, defensive coach, is over there talking to the defensive side, which is very important. That defensive unit for the Cougars right now is losing track of their men. They're leaving Colorado State guys open in the crease area, and Colorado State has been able to capitalize on those on that open space.
So we've got that McKechnie save, I think, coming here in the replay, and you can see Ryan Davis coming up. McKechnie just deflecting it over the goal, but would have been a huge opportunity for CSU to continue the momentum. BYU comes back with a goal by Hardy, and instead of being a four-goal deficit, it's only a two-goal deficit.
You know, I thought that was a missed shot, and I'm wrong. That was a terrific save, point-blank save.
And you can see there the number of shots and opportunities are really to BYU because CSU has 6 saves to 3. So they're just not capitalizing. Alex Smith stepping up with some nice saves. And we've got BYU now in an even situation with Randall Cohn handling it. Back to Mike Lee, over to Archibald.
You know, CSU lost their standout goalie last year, Kale Van Valkenburg, and leaving a question mark at the goal, but I think that question mark is answered. Alex Smith is really having a terrific game.
He's a junior, the team president, and doing a fine job for CSU here today. And you can see bodies flying all over.
Wow.
Some nice pickup by Randall Cohn. Bodies flying all over the place. These teams want this game. And what do we got here? A moving pick on CSU. So once Cale Nelson picked up that ball, we had some contact there by Jared Katz on Hardy. and it goes back to BYU. You can see the hustle here. Bodies flying all over the place. And there was a moving pick back here. You couldn't see it was off the screen, but a moving pick against CSU. So once that player picks up the ball, you've got to release contact, or else you're going to call that interference call.
This is some fast lacrosse here tonight. This game is really played in the air, and when it's a great game, you're just not going to see the ball on the ground very much. It's going to be mostly a skills game, and that's what I see out here right now.
And you've got Archibald going against Blaschinski, and just trying to stuff it in there, unable to do so, gets in the crease. The referees call a play-on situation. Blaschinski comes out of it. Chris Rucker now forces him on the sideline, pushes him out of bounds, and we've got a flag from behind.
Yeah, I think you got a good, that's a good flag.
And now we've got a taunting, unsportsmanlike conduct penalty on Blaschinski. Blaschinski is going to get a one-minute penalty for taunting, unsportsmanlike conduct. Really unfortunate because CSU had a man-up situation, and they don't show it here on the replay, but now he goes up and he kind of gets in the face of a BYU player, and the referee stopped that right away.
That's a mental mistake. They already had the penalty. It was an obvious penalty. The flag said everything that that they needed to have made the statement, and now they lose that man-up opportunity.
And you can see the referee here explaining it to him. So we've got a 30-second penalty on CSU. We've got a 30-second penalty as well.
Okay.
So we're going to be in an even situation again with double penalties on both teams. And the CSU bench just up in arms on that one. But, we could see it from here. He did go and say something and was somewhat taunting the bench. And referees, again, I think just really trying to keep control of this game.
And they need to. And Coach Nomberg, knowing how important that man-up situation was to be for CSU, really making the point that you got to keep your head, let the penalties speak for themselves, and that's a man-up situation wasted for CSU.
But it happened right in front of us. It was an obvious push in the back, and CSU just reacting poorly, so we've got an even situation. And I believe the ball is going to go to BYU because of the conduct foul. I believe the ball goes to BYU, so it's kind of a double penalty for CSU in a sense that they would have had possession and a man up, but the ball goes to BYU in this case.
We're in another situation where there's two less guys on the field. There's going to be more space. Field is going to open up a little bit. Colorado State was able to capitalize on that and score quickly. Let's see if BYU can use that advantage.
So you've got Dave Rucker now taking it. He's going against Cale Nelson, usually has a short stick in his hand. He's got a long stick in his hand, playing that defensive role. Rucker with some wheels going by him. Nelson trying to get that Peel with the shot. Oh, and Alex Smith comes up huge. Jordan Peel had a nice shot. Alex Smith just picking that one out of the air. Huge save for the CSU Rams. And there's Napolili winging one wide. Ryan Davis backs it up.
That was great ball movement by the Rams there. This Colorado State team is really fired up.
Jordan Peel had a shot about 12 yards out. Just unable to put it by Smith. Again, I think Smith up high is phenomenal. I think he's been great up high. I think where you got to beat him is down low.
I think so. That had been the book on him, shoot high. But I agree with you, Marty. I think they need to put these shots on the ground.
The couple shots that they've had have been low that have been goals, these high shots. And there's Quiggle missing Farquhar. Farquhar's going to the right. There he goes with a nice shot. Just shoots it wide left. But Quiggle was supposed to be on him. You can see the bench is yelling at him, get on number 13. And they are mixed up. They are mixed up. BYU's defense was out of position. And they got lucky that ball went to the midfield line. They were out of position. They were able to recover. And here comes Quiggle.
And
there's the problem right there.
Great shot by Farquhar.
There's the problem for BYU right there. Number 13 at the midfield, Farquhar just going to the right. And there's no secret. He scored 5 of those goals against CU yesterday the exact same way. No secret.
There is an obvious mismatch situation right here. The Colorado State middies and attackmen are have an advantage over the Cougar defense. They're confused down there. The Cougar defense is confused down there. They're missing assignments, and it's leaving clear paths to the goal for Colorado State offensive players.
But there's two things that were contrary to, I know, BYU's game plan, was that one, have a long stick on him, and two, force him to the left. And they let him go to the right, and they had a short stick on him. Two mistakes there by BYU. Cost him another goal. So now you got McClure and Eichhorn out there facing off. And let's see, what are we going to call here? We're calling a withholding on BYU, so that's going to go to CSU. CSU wins their first faceoff at an opportune time for them.
Now, if you remember in the Sonoma State game, right here in the second quarter, Sonoma State started pulling away. The Cougar team lost a lot of energy. They were not able to pull together as a team until the fourth quarter. Let's see if the Cougar team can regroup a lot earlier and turn this back into a contest.
And CSU trying to get that across the crease there, knocking it out of bounds. It's going to go to BYU. So they do get an opportunity, able to stop another opportunity by CSU. We're going to see the offense for BYU here once again. And again, a lot of things changing up for BYU. I think maybe some of the defensive changes confuse them a little bit. Jeff Jackson with the short stick in his hand still. Aaron Quiggle on the midi defensive line. I believe he was supposed to have number 13, Farquhar, and just didn't happen for BYU. There's Jimmy Young now clearing it for the Cougars. Big, strong defenseman. Able to clear it. Needs to get into the box.
Yeah, you better get
into the
box.
Gets it into Dave Rueckert. Nice job by Jimmy Young handling it. Mike Lee over to Hardy. Ran a cone up to Jordan Peele. Jordan Peele has been stuffed twice by Alex Smith on those high shots. And there's Mike Lee making a nice roll around. Rex Hardy picking it up behind. Looks like Mike Lee just wanted to take an opportunity. Here goes Rex against Schmidt. Sees a man on the crease, Dave Rueckert. There's a nice feed by Hardy. You saw Dave Rueckert's man come off. He was able to make the pass.
It's classic Rex Hardy lacrosse. He does something special. He uses that frame. He gets in close to the cage. He draws the double team and then hits that pass right on the button.
You can see the defender there, number one for CSU, Cale Nelson, coming off of his man Rueckert, leaving him open. Hardy finds him on the crease. It's textbook double team lacrosse. When you have a man double down on you, there's going to be a man open. It's the first thing they teach you, and Rex Hardy just worked it to perfection there.
Yeah, it's one of those special things that Rex Hardy can do.
So now you got Mike Spencer again, BYU with another faceoff. Dominating faceoffs today, doing a fabulous job, which is giving them possession and the opportunities which they need because they're not taking advantage of the ones they have.
I shudder to think what would be happening if they were not dominating faceoffs.
There's Archibald, he's forcing it, and he scores a goal. And we've got a penalty as well.
Beautiful.
We've got a penalty. The referee threw a flag, so it's got to be a penalty on CSU. What is the call here? What is the call? He's calling a loose ball push, but how could he do that when he was scoring a goal?
Well, if it were a loose ball push, we wouldn't see a flag. I think we're going to get a technical push from behind with possession. Or are they pulling the flag off?
I'm not sure what's happening here, but let's see. I haven't seen a goal indication yet. I haven't seen a goal indication. I think Coach Lamb is certainly concerned because if it's a push, he's shooting, and the goal goes in before he lands, that's a goal.
Unless there's been a rule change, I don't understand what's going on.
He's calling no goal. Referees are discussing.
Well, if there was a no goal, again, there would have to have been a penalty on the Cougars because Cougars had possession in that entire sequence.
Unless he's calling Archibald in the crease.
Which he may be doing.
Before the shot.
That is possible.
And that's very close. His foot may have been on the line, and if that's the case, they're going to call no goal because he was in the crease, but give the Cougars the ball and the penalty. And there's Hank Friedman. We've had a fine referee crew here today. I think they're doing a fine job so far. Hank Friedman, David Haig, and Michael Malley. Here's the call. No goal. Green penalty on number four, Joe Glashinsky. So there's a push with possession. And we're getting an explanation right now why the goal doesn't count.
I am very confused. Usually it's a play-on situation when there's a penalty on green. If Jordan Archibald stepped into the crease prior to the shot, that should be a change of possession, no penalty, and possession should switch over to Colorado State. So I'm very confused. If it was a penalty on Colorado State, which is what they're calling, it's a play-on situation, and the goal should count, as it should have before.
The only issue is if they're calling Jordan in the crease before the shot. There's Archibald taking another shot. He wants another chance to get back at it. Unable to come up with a loose ball. And there goes, who came up with it? Price for CSU. Bringing it down the field. They're running a Gilman clear, which is Gilman. Just to throw it down the field. McKechnie coming out. McKechnie, a very good goalie outside the cage. Peel up to Rueckert. Again, still in a man-up situation. Gets it up to Archibald. Sees Hardy. And there's a nice goal by BYU. BYU taking advantage of CSU being out of position. Archibald to Hardy, finish it off.
Terrific, terrific sequence. And there you saw, in an unsettled situation, Colorado State being out of position, leaving the Cougar attackman open on the crease.
But it really started McKechnie coming out, playing very well outside the cage, getting it up the field, gets it to Rukert, who gets it over to Archibald on a skip pass, who sees Hardy now cutting to the crease.
It's beautiful.
And that's a tough task for Alex Smith to stop that goal.
You know, you could also argue that that starts with the Gilman clear, which is popular in a lot of high school JV teams, and I'm not sure why Colorado State is running that Gilman clear, which is simply not to try and find anybody open at the midlines, but to toss it all the way down the field.
You'll oftentimes see that in man-down situations where you don't have the manpower to get it down the field. I think they were just trying to get it out of their zone so they could regroup, but McKechnie coming out was able to turn it around very quickly for BYU.
I don't like the Gilman clear, and I've never liked it because it's as if you're just giving up. You're saying, hey, we're going to throw it down the field and see what happens, and let the Cougars set up a beautiful clear on a nice fast break.
And now you've got BYU a little bit unsettled on defense. They're not matching up very well. As CSU settles it down, now BYU able to get with their men. And we've got Napalili against Kubesh.
Really, one of the few times in this game that CSU has run their settled offense.
And it didn't look that way for just a second, but BYU was able to regroup and force him into a settled situation. So here we've got Stannis Harper up top. Over to Napalili. CSU going for the attack midfield inverted offense a little bit here as well. As you've got now Ryan Davis up top and Napalili up top. So here goes Ryan Davis with the shot. McKechnie able to save it. Nice beat on it by McKechnie.
And a great face dodge by Ryan Davis.
We are at 5-4. CSU leading BYU with 6:32 left in the second quarter. And CSU in a settled situation now. CSU's switched up here a little bit, putting their middies back up to the top. Number 25, John Knob, going against McClure. Over to Ryan Davis. They're running a little motion offense, kind of picking across, crossing. There's Jimmy Young going against Davis. Davis goes down, there's Knob, and we've got a penalty flag down, so that's going to be on the defense. Napalili shoots it high against McKechnie. It's going to be against BYU.
Napalili wants that one back. That was very uncharacteristic for him. It was about 6 inches high off the cage, which is a feat because he was pretty close to the cage for the shot.
So here's the penalty right there. And you can see Knob over to Napalili, and he just shoots it high.
He was looking at a lot of open cage right there, but not taking anything away from McKechnie. Both of these goalies are having great games tonight.
So Napalili one-on-one with McKechnie. McKechnie able to force him high. And we're going to have a man-up situation for CSU. So CSU kind of starts in a little bundle at the top of the box, getting in the position so that BYU can't match up initially. Cale Nelson up top. Quigley coming out challenging. This is very characteristic of BYU. They do this on their man down. They will go out and challenge. A lot of times you'll just see a team pack it in on man down, but BYU out there aggressively challenging. So Stannis Harper up to Nelson. Over to Napalili. Doug Creevy missing that pass. And again, Taylor Cotterill up to Creevy. And we've got a whistle and a ward. We've got a warding off penalty on number 12, Creevy. Change of possession to BYU.
And the aggressive defense on the man down really pays off for the Cougars in that case.
Really what you had there was you had a player who was pushing off with his free arm. And now you've got Rex Hardy in a man-down situation, scores a goal. BYU in a man-down situation, evens up the score 5-5.
Rex Hardy is taking his team and putting them on his shoulders and saying, follow me. He's such a great player and a great leader.
So starting with the penalty, Aaron Quigley able to clear it, gets it to Hardy. One-on-one man on Schmidt, puts it by Smith. Now again, you saw that shot, Charlie, was low.
It's a good adjustment. It's really a good adjustment. I think it is the only way tonight that the Cougar attackmen are going to beat Alex Smith.
So we are tied 5-5 with 5:26 remaining in the second quarter. Rex Hardy tonight, 4 goals and an assist. So in the 5 goals, he's got 5 points.
Rex Hardy is the kind of attacker that I never, ever wanted to face on the field. His combination of speed and strength, field savvy, it's... But he is a nightmare for he is a nightmare assignment for defense.
So BYU winning another faceoff by virtue of a technical penalty, CSU with a procedure penalty, and BYU controlling again. I believe they've only lost one faceoff so far today, so that is a great sign for BYU so far in this game. Being tied 5-5, BYU seems to have won possession and control and opportunities, but haven't been able to execute, just like right there, Mike Lee bumping it out of bounds.
That's a tough loss of possession there. But in talking with Coach Lamb after the Sonoma State game, he was so concerned about the team's reaction when Sonoma State started to pull away. He has to be relieved that the team is...
And there's a shot and a goal by Stanton Harper.
And a terrific, terrific shot. And he beat McKechnie low on that goal.
The people were in position on that one for BYU. Jim Young was right there. And he just put it by McKechnie.
You know, this grass may be a little slick from the moisture we had earlier, and these shots aren't slowing down when they're hitting the ground. They may be getting uneven bounces, and both teams, I think, would be well advised from this point forward to keep all their shots on the ground.
That shot bounced about 15 yards outside of the goal, and goalies don't normally see that thing happening outside 15 yards bouncing, so I think it caught him by surprise a little bit. Another faceoff situation. BYU out there fighting for it, but comes up with Jared Katz. CSU winning the faceoff. And they're going to go right to the goal. Jared Katz going right to the goal. McKechnie with a nice save.
Great save by McKechnie.
Kubish now coming after for BYU. Napalili coming up with it for CSU. Still on the ground.
Who wants it more?
Bodies flying all over. Kubish comes in, knocks over the pile. And we got to push from behind on Jimmy Young. Push from behind on Jimmy Young.
And they're technical.
They're calling a technical on that, which is unusual because the ball was loose.
Yeah, that one I don't understand. If you have unnecessary roughness, that's a personal foul. That's 1 minute. Well, in an unsettled situation, how do you come up with a technical foul on a push?
That, if you ask me, that's a reputation foul. Jimmy Young, reputation for being very aggressive, gets a few penalties, and that, it's, you know... It does. I'm speechless because in a loose ball situation, whether it's from behind or in front, almost always it's a technical change of possession foul.
Yeah, well, but I'm confused. I'm not sure that foul is in the book. Yeah. I mean, if in an unsettled situation, a player is too aggressive or is coming too high in his hits on another player. That's an unnecessary roughness. That's 1 minute. So I don't know how they come up with 30-second penalty.
So CSU is going to be up for 30 seconds in a man-up situation. This game getting very aggressive. You can see what's going on. I believe Rand Champion has something for us on the sideline. Rand?
All right, thanks, Marty. We talked to Coach Nomber before the game, and he talked about how the key to this game was to keep BYU from making this into a track meet. He's done a great job so far sticking two long sticks on both Harding and Archibald. They've started to figure that out, and it's starting to become a very close game. He's starting to get a little concerned, especially since they've also had two goals called back.
Thanks, Rand. This game has sped up, and the bodies are starting to fly. And this could be very interesting going into halftime. We've got 4 minutes left in the half, and CSU is going to be up here. You take a look here at the last penalty. Bodies were flying all over. Kubesh comes in, clears out the pile. Now, that one they didn't call. And now here comes Young, and they call a 30-second technical push from behind penalty on that. Very unusual.
Well, there was no possession, so that's either just a change of possession penalty or a 1 minute personal foul. So I guess that you could say that the Cougars got a good break there because Young should be in the box 30 seconds long.
So now he has CSU's man up unit out there. Napalili just throws it away. Napalili just throws that away. Stanitz Harper looking at him going, "What was that?" And BYU is going to have an opportunity to clear it here. A good break here for BYU, but unusual to see the CSU players looking at each other like, what was that? What was that?
What was that? That
Eric Quiggle throwing
the most confusing lacrosse play that I've ever seen.
Eric Quiggle threw it right to Ryan Davis, who was standing on the crease, and there was no goalie. Puts it right in.
That is very, those are two very strange back-to-back plays.
I mean, there is no Cougar in the vicinity. He passed it right to him.
He you know, it looks like he just didn't realize the goalie was. I mean, it has to have been. He thought the goalie was in position. His eyes were upfield as he threw it in the cage area. Very, very, with nice presence of mind, Ryan Davis was sitting right where he needed to be, great position, right in front of the cage, and could capitalize on that mistake.
The only explanation is that he thought that Ryan Davis was a BYU player because he just passed it right to him, and just an unfortunate situation for BYU. But and now we've got a failure to advance. BYU unable, well, they won the faceoff, but unable to get it into the restraining box in the 10-second time limit. So, get a failure to advance penalty. And now CSU clearing, and CSU calls a timeout. So CSU leading 7-5 on really two mistakes by BYU. And if you look at the goals that CSU has scored so far, they've been goals capitalizing on BYU mistakes.
This is a tough one to swallow. The Cougars were down early. They fought, clawed back into the game, and tied the thing up. Had the momentum, and then a couple of mental mistakes, and they're back down again by two goals.
You can see we've got a nice crowd tonight. School's out. BYU graduation was yesterday, so students have gone home, but we've got a good contingent of family and friends and locals who have come out to see the Cougars here tonight. The RMILL Championship, some other teams in town as well. And an exciting game tonight. I mean, a lot of good lacrosse we've seen so far, but we've also just seen some really strange mistakes.
This is one of those games that I wait for all year. I know that every player on this field has this game marked on their calendar. And boy, we're gonna have a great second half coming up here. And this one, I'm pretty confident this one's gonna be tight right down to the wire.
So we've got an even up situation. BYU will be on the defense. Cale Nelson taking it for CSU. Gonna be defended there by Quiggle. Now, I think Quiggle's had a less than par game so far. And you know, I think we're gonna see him step it up here over the course of the remainder of this game. But the BYU defense just looks a little bit out of sync today.
Well, we're seeing some nice lacrosse out here, but I think both teams are going to go into halftime, and they're going to say, we're not playing as well as we can play. And both teams just have not hit their stride yet.
And there you saw a nice play by Aaron Quiggle, getting it back. Cale Nelson on the crease, and Quiggle just right there with a nice check. Now, Jimmy Young, nobody's checking him. He's going to go to the goal, and he takes a shot, just goes wide, but nobody was checking him, so he was just going to take it to the cage, which is really what you should do. If nobody's going to come pick you up, take it to the hoop.
He looked surprised that nobody was on him. He needs to take a more direct route to the cage in that case and put it on the ground.
And you saw that shot go wide. You young players, as you see these guys shoot, you see a lot of them wind up sidearm. Jimmy Young, it's exactly what he did and shot it wide. If he would have come overhand, he would have put it right on the cage, had a good opportunity for a goal. So.
And he would have had a faster release on his shot. Just without getting fancy, just take it right to the cage, put it on the ground with a nice fast release. It would have had a better chance of going in.
So we see this inverted offense again here for BYU with the short sticks going behind. Jordan Peele with a nice little roll dodge, but Cale Nelson with some nice defense against him for CSU. Jordan Peele getting knocked into the crease. Knocked into the crease. It's going to CSU. Jordan Archibald on the sideline pleading with Coach Lamb to not run that offense anymore.
Is that what he was saying?
I think that's what he was saying. Or at least give it to the attack up top and let them run against defenders who aren't used to running from the top of the restraining box.
You know, he may have a point. The strength of this team right now definitely is the attack line. They have some standouts there. And they're not taking advantage.
And there's Jordan Peele with his interception. He's got wheels on his guy. We're going to see a fast break opportunity for the Cougars. Textbook triangle. Hardy with the shot. And not backed up by BYU. CSU is going to get the ball.
That was great. Great fast break defense by CSU. Normally, the offensive team in that situation is looking to make three crisp passes, rotate the ball, find the open man, and put it in the cage. And CSU shut off all of their outlets. It was just great fast break defense.
Rex Hardy got that ball on the point, wasn't able to get it to anybody, and then just took the shot himself, and his help wasn't behind. So, and there's a check there by Jeff Jackson. They're offsides, but didn't get the call. Didn't get the call. Didn't get the call. Oh, and they're going to get a penalty right there. As soon as you see a guy like that get jacked back, you're going to get a penalty. Coach Lamb needs to be a little bit careful. He's throwing the cone out on the field. He's not happy. He saw CSU with an offsides. The referees didn't catch it. He's not happy with it because now it's going to result in a BYU penalty.
And the referees are in hot water right now, I can tell you, with both coaches.
You can see here, he just catches him with the stick, and whenever you see a guy's head go back like that, the flags are coming out of the pockets. It was a good call on the penalty, but I think BYU's concern is that it resulted from a missed offside penalty against CSU.
Well, the referees clearly missed an offside penalty. It happens. It's part of the game. You can't expect every penalty to be called correctly, but that was another missed penalty on a CSU fast break. It was an important possession situation. We only have a minute and a half left here. CSU has got a great scoring opportunity as a result of that sequence, not to mention that I think the two goals were taken away from the Cougars on inadvertent whistles that I just don't understand. And so Coach Lamb has got, I think he has a real beef here. And these officials are, I can guarantee you as an official, an occasional high school official myself, I can guarantee you that they're feeling it.
Now, Charlie, you'll see that BYU has four defenders out there. There was a subsequent penalty called on the bench for unsportsmanlike conduct. So BYU is two men down right now. BYU only in they're going into a box situation on their man down, but they are two men down in this situation. Coach Lamb was not happy about that and got a bench penalty, so an additional 30 seconds on the penalty.
Boy, this is an opportunity that CSU really needs to take advantage of. They could go in three goals up at halftime with all of the momentum.
There's just a few seconds left on the first penalty for BYU. CSU not able to get a shot off yet. Now the first penalty is released. There's a shot and a goal by Ryan Davis.
And a laser of a shot.
So BYU in a two-man down situation, unable to stop the man-up offense of CSU. And they go down by three goals with 54 seconds left in the second quarter. And you can just see this shot right here. Just blew it right by McKechnie.
Kids, he didn't do anything fancy there. He had it in his sidearm position. Quick release. He had a good beat on the goal. That was a great shot.
So with 54 seconds left here in the first half, CSU leads BYU with a score of 8-5. And I'll tell you, there's been some unique opportunities to score here tonight. And just really both teams taking advantage of the mistakes of the other.
As you can tell, I'm sure, and I can certainly feel it down here on the field, both teams are excited. Both teams realize what's at stake here, and we are going to see going into the second half here, I'm sure, an incredible, incredible second half of lacrosse.
A bright spot for BYU is their dominance in the faceoffs. They win another one. Mike Spencer, Phil McClure, Dave Rooker doing a fine job on faceoffs. They've had the possession, they've had the opportunities, but they've really only looked to Rex Hardy to score.
There's two things that BYU needs to fix, and I hope that they'll be discussing this at length at halftime, maybe here in this timeout. But I am not a believer, as you pointed out, and I think Jordan Archibald also feels this way in the inverted offense at this point. I think that it's more desirable to have the ball in the sticks of the great BYU attackman than the midfielders down low. I understand how coach wants mismatches down there, and he wants short sticks defending offensive players down near the cage. But I think that's a mistake, and the BYU defense really needs to make sure that they're getting their assignments here. They're missing their guys. They're letting the CSU attackman roam free down there. They're letting the CSU attackman get into space. They've got to play tighter defense on these guys.
Yeah, you see the midfielders, when they get inverted, they feel like they have an opportunity to go against the short stick, but they're not used to working down there. That's the issue, is they're not used to working behind the cage, and it hasn't been real successful for BYU so far. And I agree with you on the defense. They just seem a little bit confused as to what they're supposed to be doing out there. I know they've thrown in a few wrinkles for this game, but nothing that should be that complex. So.
And when you have an attack line like Archibald, Hardy, and Lee, I think that you have a real strength there, and it's a real advantage to keep the ball in their sticks.
So BYU calling the timeout, wanting to get another opportunity to score here before the half. 30 seconds left. I think BYU's just looking to get one good shot, good scoring opportunity. And here's Hardy, quarterbacking from behind. Sees a cutter, Randall Cohn, and he scores! Randall Cohn from the crease scores a goal. So BYU with 19 seconds left, a little momentum going into the half, scoring 8-6.
It's a great cut by Randall Cohn. It's great vision by Rex Hardy here.
So Randall Cohn able to finish on this. Rex Hardy just sees his man. Cohn cutting and puts it past Alex Smith. So BYU with a nice little play, designed it right before the half. Now, the worst thing that could happen for BYU right now is to lose this faceoff, give up a quick fast break goal.
That would definitely be a problem here. But that goal right there, however unlikely, but that goal right there was a terrific momentum changer, and we are going to have a dandy of a second.
That was an illegal procedure on CSU. So BYU is going to have the ball with 18 seconds left and another opportunity to score.
Well, the worst thing that could happen for CSU right now is for BYU to come down and put two quick goals in there with 30 seconds left in the half.
There's 15 seconds left. Rex Hardy with the ball. Sees a cutter. Mike Lee on the crease.
Oh,
Alex
great
Smith.
Save by Alex Smith.
Alex Smith saving a potentially huge goal. And we've got a penalty. And it's against CSU. A penalty against CSU. Now, this is going to create an interesting situation because if BYU holds the ball here,
which they should be able to do,
then they will have possession starting the second half. They won't have to face off. So here's Mike Lee. Wide open situation. And Alex Smith. Oh! He just got him in the tweener there.
That's going to leave a mark.
That one's got to hurt, but Alex Smith coming up huge, stopping Mike Lee on the crease.
That is going to leave a mark. It's just one of those reasons why goalies are just a little bit nuts.
Yeah, we mentioned that last night, and there's evidence of it. So BYU holding on to the ball, and that will result in no face-off to start the second half. BYU will retain possession, and they're going to be man up for almost a minute for the second half. But BYU getting that last goal before the half was very important. Now we've got Coach Nomberg on the sideline with Rand Champion. Rand?
I'm here with Coach Nomberg. Coach, this has got to be kind of what you wanted to start. You said you didn't want a track meet for this game. Is this what the defense you want to have?
We're very pleased with how we're playing defense and just holding together. They're, you know, Archibald and Hardy are real tough, and we're just trying to hold on the best we can.
You've kind of thrown some looks at BYU that they weren't expecting, which has led to some goals. Is that going to keep up in the second half?
You mean defensively or offensively? Yeah, we are. We're going to try not to slide quite as much and make it open it up as much as they want us to. So we're trying to hold tight on defense.
Great, Coach. Thanks a lot. Good luck in the second half. Back to you guys.
Thanks, Rand. Appreciate that. And Coach Nomberg, again, you didn't want to get into a track meet, but it's been one so far today, Charlie. We're going to be right back for halftime with the Rams leading the Cougars 8-6.
$50 invested in a mutual fund 20 years ago returned $452. $50 in the United Negro College Fund returned an award-winning actor. A mind is a terrible thing to waste.
Welcome back to the RMILL Championship here at Southfield on the campus of Brigham Young University. And Charlie, we have got a barn burner of a game here today. The Rams leading the Cougars 8-6. This game being billed as a track meet, and I think it's lived up to its billing.
Yeah, you know, I was very interested in what Coach Nomberg had to say, and they've had some terrific offensive play here.
Well, this is a championship weekend. It's featured the Division II championship game, and also an all-star game, which featured some of the Division I and Division II all-stars in a game prior to this. You can see they divided up. It was a Utah versus Colorado format. So some of the Utah schools, including University of Utah, Utah State, Weber State, were involved in this game versus Western State, Colorado School of Mines, and some of the Colorado schools. And you can see here some of the footage from that game, different players from different schools getting together, more just kind of for fun.
Yeah, this is going to be your typical all-star game, which it was. A lot of scoring, a lot of action, not too much defense.
Yeah, defense not a priority. These players not really playing with each other. They don't have a good feel for how each other work, but as all-stars, all have some talents. And from all intents and purposes, it seemed to be a pretty fun game for these guys. And it's been a great weekend here for the championship weekend. Earlier today in the Division II finals, Boise State defeated Utah State for the Division II championship, and that was a great game as well. And So it's good to see the growth within the league, within the nation. Some of these teams, Boise State, their program's only 3 years old.
We saw a few teams rise this year, Boise State and Utah appearing in the Final Four.
You can take a look here at some of the Division II All-Stars, which were also named in the luncheon this morning from Utah State. And you can see some of these schools, Utah State represented, University of Northern Colorado, Western State University in Colorado, a number of Boise State players, Rich Glenn, Brian Sanderson, David Bruns. Again, Boise State only for 3 years. And the offensive MVP there for D2, Nick Clapula from University of Northern Colorado, and defensive MVP Brandon Payne from BSU. So, and the overall MVP Nick Clapula from UNC. So for Division I, you can see a lot of the players here that are playing in this game highlighted, and you can see that they dominate the nominations.
Yeah, these rosters here are pretty familiar. Seeing Roy Borkin from CU, he's really a terrific player. I liked what I saw out of him last night. Also, Pete Myers at the midfield. CU, they just had a terrific effort last night. That was just a great lacrosse game to see. I think we got a dandy here in the second half, though.
So you can see there the offensive MVP, Jordan Archibald, defensive MVP, Mark Plonkey, who's not here in the game today, Division I MVP, Rex Hardy, and Jason Lamb. So great weekend here for the championship. We're going to be right back in just a moment. Stay with us.
Programming on BYU TV is made possible by contributing viewers and by the BYU Bookstore. These and other fine art prints by Greg Olson, Del Parsons, and other renowned artists are available at the BYU Bookstore. Incredibly, medical knowledge doubles every 5 to 7 years, which makes it extremely hard for most doctors to keep up. But at University Hospital in Salt Lake City, we're committed to staying on the forefront of medical knowledge and technology. Which simply means, when it comes to the latest in medicine, we're right on top of it. University Hospital. We couldn't care more.
Hello, baby!
Welcome back to halftime as the BYU Cougars trail the Colorado State Rams 8-6. We're here with Coach Lamb. And Coach Lamb, it seems like you guys have dominated possession, you've dominated faceoffs, but haven't been able to capitalize on all the opportunities.
Yeah, faceoffs have been a nice surprise. We've been able to do some things I didn't think we were going to be able to do. Possessions is the key. CSU takes care of their possessions. We need to do a better job to take care of our possessions. That was about the only thing I had to say at halftime is, when we have the ball, it better be worth $1 million, because if we treat it for anything less, they're gonna take care of it on the other end. Yeah.
This CSU offense is powerful. What are the keys to your defense stopping them in the second half?
Hands down, I mean, the biggest problem we're having with their offense is transition. Their 6-on-6 offense is good, but I think our 6-on-defense is just as good. We've given up our goals. I think 6 out of the 8 have been transition goals. So if we just don't do dumb things in the middle of the field, we have a shot, and that's the only, that is what I told them about the defense.
Have some of the new wrinkles been a problem for you, or is it just executing right now?
I told the guys, you know, the game plan is not the issue at hand. It's one of these great matches where heart and hustle matter more than anything. We could throw the game plan out because ultimately it's just a war out there, and the kids are fighting. The refs are doing a good job. Coaches are coaching, and players are playing. And you know, you want to be in a game like this. But that's what it's going to come down to: is heart and hustle. And we could scrap the game plan, but I mean, we're going to stick to it. But I mean, it's not the game plan that I'm worried about. It's how bad do we want that ground ball? How bad do we want to have that possession?
We've seen those bodies flying around so far. We expect it to continue. We want to thank Coach Lamb for coming in here And we're going to step aside here for just a second. Stay with us. We're going to be right back with the second half after this. Go get it.
I took my high school's required health course through BYU Independent Study.
Stacy Lewis, salutatorian, Las Vegas High School, 2001.
I liked that I could study at my own pace and on my own time and free up my schedule to take other classes during the year.
Brigham Young University Independent Study offers a full range of courses for students wanting to get ahead, many of the courses right over the internet.
I would recommend BYU Independent Study to any student.
Welcome back to halftime here at the RMILL Championships. The number two seeded Colorado State Rams lead the number one seeded BYU Cougars 8-6. And Charlie, take a look at these Cougar Club's halftime stats.
They're looking pretty tight. Ground balls, BYU up 20-14. That's a nice stat. Shots on goal are pretty close. Cougars with the advantage there. Nine penalties for Colorado State in the first half is a lot. So is seven penalties for BYU. So both teams have had their man-up situations. Saves, Alex Smith is just having a terrific game. Playing really great in the cage. Faceoffs is the one stat that's lopsided in favor of BYU. And I shudder to think what would be happening right now for the Cougars if that one was more even, giving Colorado State more possession opportunities.
And he really said that Coach Lamb was really talking about the opportunities that they've had and just haven't been able to capitalize, you know. And here's a good example of it, where Jordan Peele comes up with this interception, races down the field, and the Cougars have a fast break opportunity there, and they're just unable to capitalize on these opportunities. I mean, it was a perfect defense creating opportunity for the offense, and then the offense not being able to finish it.
Yeah, that and a few mental mistakes. I very uncharacteristically, Aaron Quiggle absolutely gave a goal away, and I'm still shaking my head at that one. I can't understand what I've never seen anything like that on a lacrosse field before.
Yeah, that was unbelievable. The only thing I think that can explain that is just that he must have thought that was a BYU player standing there in front of the crease, because he just passed it right to him. So
it's a shame that the green that he was wearing didn't tip him off.
But you can see here, we're going to start with possession going to BYU. Now, if you recall, we had that one situation where Jordan Archibald seemed to score a goal, but they waved it off. We saw the referees explaining what the call was at halftime. They waved it off because Jordan Archibald had stepped on the crease before the shot. So there was no shot because he was in the crease. And because they had the penalty, the flag, that's why it went to BYU. But there was no shot because he stepped on the crease. So here's BYU in their man-up offense. Again, they rotated around. It looks like they're not doing too much, but they want to make that defense into a bad rotation. And there's a skip pass, just a bad pass by Jordan Peele. I think he had the right thing in mind, but just unable to execute once again.
It's another one of those mental mistakes that the Cougars just can't seem to overcome tonight.
So you've got to now CSU Price going to clear it now for CSU. And we had a substitution, and the people that came on came right back off. So coach is changing their mind mid-substitution. So Jordan Archibald riding Price. And Price is beating Archibald. And now they're calling an offsides on CSU. The BYU bench calling that well before the referees, but referees got that one. So offsides on CSU, it goes back to BYU. They're still in a man-up situation for approximately another 30 seconds or so. Jordan Peele over to Dave Rueckert. Cougars, again, patiently moving that ball around in their offense. And again,
patiently. We're on a one-minute penalty, and the Cougars haven't taken a shot yet.
And again, mishandling the ball the second time. There's Randall Cohn, gets it over to Hardy, throws it at his feet.
Well, actually, that was terrific fundamental defense by the Rams there. Deflected off of a Ram defensive stick.
And there goes Jared Katz. He's run through four Cougars now. Dave Ruckert able to stay with him. Dave Ruckert sliding across the field. You can see how wet it is. Number 21, Jim Hassan for the Rams. Gets it over to Stannis Harper. He's going to crank from there. Besides better of it, Jason Hunt against him. And nobody's on Farquhar. He'll crank with the right hand. Randall Cohn. Kubesh against Napalili, who scores.
That was very, very, that's some nice offensive movement there. There were chances for about four shots in that sequence, and Colorado State players played very intelligently. They took the best shot opportunity in that situation.
So there were a couple of opportunities there. CSU capitalizes on it again. BYU out of position again as Farquhar, really the start of that, Farquhar coming onto the field, nobody covering him. Two BYU defenders have to jump off on him. He gives it over to Napalili, and everybody's happy for CSU.
And Farquhar could have taken that shot, but seeing that there was an open man because of the double team, he hit the open man, and it was great lacrosse.
So here goes another face-off situation. And Mike Spencer coming out of that pile with the ball. Gets checked there by the CSU player. Ball still on the ground.
Who wants it more? It's like Coach was talking about.
And then Aaron Quigle coming in, clearing out the pile, but getting the loose ball push penalty. Happens a lot. If you get a pile that's stagnant like that, you get a player that comes in and tries to clear it out. There's oftentimes gets a penalty because he's going to hit somebody in the back, like right there.
Yeah, he got him square in the back. There's just no question about it.
And there's Farquhar. And there's a nice
check
by Quigle.
Oh,
and now you got
goodness.
Mike Lee on the fast break with BYU. Archibald trying to put it by Smith. Hardy not in position to back it up, and it goes to CSU. Price, nice backup. But Hardy in the fast break position, unable to back up there.
Boy, that was one terrific check by Aaron Quigle to start that fast break.
So here comes Price now for CSU. And again, mishandled by CSU. Archibald, three CSU defenders converge on him. He's unable to get it over to his help. And the ball is still loose. Archibald now picks it up. Can he push from behind by Napalili?
That was a no call in there. Should have been a push from behind with possession.
And there's Quigle against Farquhar again, challenging him at the midfield line. Aaron Quigle's got to be careful right there because he just got beat. Now he's got open man on the crease. And there's Ryan Anderson, the goal for the Cougars. Don't know why this is happening, but Ryan Anderson in for the Cougars. McKechnie playing a good game. I don't know what the rationale is here. I don't see McKechnie hurt or anything on the sideline, but Ryan Anders is in the goal now for the Cougars.
Maybe looking for a change of pace, and Anders had a nice game yesterday. And
I'll tell you, I just saw a nice little deception move by CSU. Farquhar running off the field as if he was going to come off, and Eric Quigle running with him, and he changes directions and goes right back in.
I just love what both teams are doing here. This is... both teams sensing this is the second half of the championship, getting excited, and playing some great ball out there.
So, again, I'm not sure, not to question Coach Lamb, but I don't know that I make a goalie change at this point in the game. So now number 21, Jim Hassan, controlling for the Rams, over to Stannis Harper, fakes the pass. Gets over to Napalili, to Davis, Napalili, Stannis Harper. Again, it's this attack, really just dominating the control. And Andrus, nice effort to get back, but the referees give it to CSU.
You know, it's the player that's closest to the ball when it goes out of bounds. And I think Andrus was pretty close in that situation.
Yeah, I think that was a closer call than maybe it looked like. A lot of players, you'll see, they'll try and run straight to the end line, but the end line is just part of it. You want to be close to the actual location the ball goes out of bounds. Here's Cale Nelson now, going against Jeff Jackson. Again, playing with the short stick in his hand today.
Which is another thing, another move that I'm just confused about.
Cale Nelson, a couple of face dodges there, unable to convert. CSU backing it up. So,
you know, Cale Nelson has such a good team behind him there that I just... I don't think that it's in Colorado State's game plan for him to go one-on-one. He just should be using his teammates in that situation.
You see here in the lax window, Cale Nelson's move going to the left. A couple of face dodges. Takes a right-handed shot wide. Dennis Harper now controlling for the Rams. Up to number 10, Mike Hamm going against Jeff Jackson. There's Ryan Davis. Back to Napalili. Ryan Kubesh against Napalili. Napalili just wanting to run him a little bit, use a little bit of time. 10:48 left here in the third quarter. CSU leading 9-6.
Great dodge.
Mo Poole beat there by his man. Is that number 12, Doug Preeby?
That is number 12, Doug Preeby, and that was one beautiful dodge.
So a nice little face dodge there on Mo Poole. Gets inside, and CSU, goes up 10-6.
I think this is their biggest lead of the game.
They were up 5-4, or 5-1, pardon me.
So we're back to a four-goal game.
It's just a little face dodge here coming around. Face dodge, boom, gets inside.
Quick move.
Yeah, tough save for any goalie to try and make that.
You know, when you're the defender in that situation, the one place that you can't give up is the inside lane on the crease. Unfortunately, that's right where Doug Preeby was able to put himself, and it was clear run to the cage from there.
That's where you really just want to knock him into the crease. And we're going to have another penalty.
Yeah.
From behind.
With possession.
From behind with possession. So Mike Spencer, again, BYU doing an outstanding job on the faceoffs. Coming up with the faceoff, Mike Spencer picks up the ground ball. And you can see here, push from behind. Boom, right there. And who's that going to be on? Number? Jared Katz.
Yeah. Those were some high flags going off by two referees that were right on top of that one.
They came right out.
No doubt about that call.
There's no question. They were both on it. And BYU's going to be in a man-up situation. Again, BYU has to take advantage of these opportunities as they're presented to them.
They've got 30 seconds. I think they need to get at least two shots off in 30 seconds. And I'd like to see them get three shots off. But I suspect that they're only going to get one.
That's been the trend. Near the end of the penalty, they will take a shot. The CSU bench getting into it. Jordan Archibald with the shot. Alex Smith smothers it. And he just throws
another
a Gilman clear. And what do we have here?
Something at the other end of the field.
Interference. Who is that on?
On Jordan Archibald.
Jordan Archibald, okay. Not sure what the interference call was. Don't know if he held somebody or if he interfered with the goalie.
It looked like that's what they called.
If the defender, as the goalie is making his pass, if any of the attackmen touch the goalie at any part of his pass, as long as he is still in the crease, that's going to be an interference call, and they're going to call a pre-clear and potentially a penalty for the opposing team. But there must have been something more, because you usually don't call a penalty, just call a change of possession. So we've got 10:09 left here in the third quarter. CSU leading 10-6. And we've got an even situation, a 5-on-5 situation. We've had a couple of those today. But they are going to be man up here in just a few seconds. And they'll be man up for about 20 seconds or so. So there's Farquhar with the shot. Anders had a beat on it. And there's a penalty, and possibly two, on Aaron Quigley.
Two penalties on Aaron Quigley. He threw an elbow after the first penalty was called. He's going to get called for that every time. An uncharacteristically sloppy game for Aaron Quigley right now.
So I think they're going to get him with a late hit, and I think they're going to get him with an unsportsmanlike conduct as well. There's a nice hit, a little bit late. Here comes the flag. Wasn't much question about it for the referee. And then here, must have said something to him. And so he gets another one. So BYU is two men down. Two men down. They're going to be two men down for about 15 seconds.
Is BYU going to be two men down, or are they going to be three men down?
I think they're going to call consecutive penalties on Quigley.
Okay.
So he will serve a minute and then a 30 second. Oh, well, let's see here. I could be completely wrong.
I think they're going to be three men down. I think the defense is going to be in a triangle there.
Well, it looks like they've also called offsetting penalties on that. So not so bad for BYU, because they've called offsetting penalties. They called a penalty on Farquhar as well for coming up and saying something to Quiggle. And so let's see here what the referee has on the final word. Because of the
that's a break.
Because of the unsportsmanlike conduct penalty, They are giving the ball to BYU. There's a good look at Steve Austin, assistant coach, two-time USLIA All-American, and great help to this BYU team. Let's see here what the final calls are here.
There is some confusion out there, and boy, tempers are flaring. It's tough on the officials right now.
The officials are talking to the coaches, making sure that they understand, hey, we're making the calls here.
This is an experienced official crew, but seems to me that they're having a little bit of trouble getting a handle on this game.
Okay, so we've got two non-releasable penalties with Farquhar and Quiggle. Archibald will be back in the game in about 15 seconds. So CSU is up for their man up for about 15 seconds, and then we're going to be in an even situation. So BYU trying to clear the ball. The long pass across the field. Brian Kubisch takes it across. We are in an even situation now. Jordan Archibald coming onto the field. Hardy now going against Schmidt. Gets it over to Archibald. Archibald's got a short stick on him. He wants to take it. He's got a short stick on him, goes right by him, and is able to take a shot off, not able to get it in. Hardy, nice backup against Smith.
That was a great run to the cage. Great, nice recognition by Jordan there. He just needed to a little bit more accurate shot.
I think at this point in the quarter, it's going to be critical for BYU to get a goal here, take advantage of this opportunity. A sloppy pass, just a lazy pass by Hardy, but Rueker taking advantage of the guy misplaying it and wings it wide. And they're going to give that to CSU. They're giving that to CSU. Price beating them on the beat to the end line.
So I actually thought that that was a pass. Do you think that was a shot?
I think that was a shot. I think that was the right call. So we're in an even situation on 5-5. Schmidt coming in and able to get over to Cale Nelson. Over to Ryan Davis. Gets it up top there to Doug Preeby. Here's number 21, Jim Hassan, controlling for the Rams. And Napolili going against Kubesh. Let's see what Napolili can do. Not much of a dodger.
Nice check by Kubesh.
Napolili not really looking for his own number this year. More of a finisher off of a pass or off of a slide. Anders getting it up to Rueckert. Rueckert's got two men to go through. He's got some good wheels. Gets around the corner. And
watch out.
That's an over and back situation. They did not call that. BYU took it out of the box, passed it back into the box.
That was a missed call. That's
and that
correct.
Was a missed call by the referees.
That's a lucky break for the Cougars.
CSU up in arms about that, which they should be. Dave Rueckert was going out of bounds, flipped the ball back behind the restraining box line, which once you bring it out, you can't go back in.
Now, it seems like this quarter has been going for a while. It's because of all these penalties and unsettled situations with the referee. We're only halfway through the third quarter right now.
7:44 left. We're right at the halfway mark. Here goes Hardy. Gets double-teamed. Turnaround shot. Unable to convert. And Randall Cohn hustling back gets it for the Cougars. Alex Smith with a diving effort. But you can see Hardy, I think he just feels like he's got to carry this team right now and is going to do everything he can to get a shot. You see here, just turns around, shoots, just misses wide. Now we're settling down Archibald, going against Leshinsky. Leshinsky. Archibald to Hardy. Archibald with a nice roll dodge.
And a very nice save again by Alex Smith.
Leshinsky had him hung up a little bit. And they're calling that CSU, which seems odd because it looked like Archibald had position.
That it does, Marty.
But we are on the far side of the field. Archibald with the pickoff. Now withholding. That's going to be withholding. Archibald picked that ball off. The CSU player Price kind of dived on the ball. You can't withhold the ball like that.
And a terrific rider. A quick whistle.
Quick whistle. Archibald's in the crease.
Was pushed into the crease, so they won't call it.
They're going to give him a play-on situation.
Streaking Jared Colorado Katz. State player. Great fast break situation. He'll settle it down. I'm not sure why.
BYU seemed to have some numbers there. They were back in the hole right in the crease area. And seem to have the advantage. So nice defense on the fast break by BYU. CSU now in another opportunity to score. BYU's really got to hold them here, down by four goals already.
Very important defensive sequence for the Cougars right now. You're right, Marty.
So here goes Ryan Davis going against Jason Hunt. Nice defense there by Hunt. Trying to get it to the man on the crease. That was Stannis Harper. And unable to get Farquhar up top, going against Dave Rueckert.
Watch out, watch out. This guy can really slash off to the top.
If Rueckert's going to play him, he's got to play him to the left. Make him go left.
Good defense.
And
good
then
defense
he almost
Dave.
Throws it away, but Ryan Davis able to pick that one out
good
of the
solid
air.
Solid body position defense. Here we
there
go
goes
again.
The right hand shot. He'll take that. Ryan Andrus had a beat on it, and it goes wide. And we're going to get another late hit penalty, this one on Jimmy Young.
Wow. These mental mistakes really, really hurt the Cougars.
You can see here in the lax window. And you didn't get to see the hit there, but Jimmy Young came in late, put him on the ground, and man-up opportunity for CSU. Just really hurts the Cougars at this point with 5:57 left in the third quarter, down by 4 goals. They can't be giving up goal opportunities to CSU. Right?
Time is now a factor in this game, and the Cougars have a real deficit here, and they need possessions and scoring opportunities. Two things they're not going to have while they're man down.
We see the CSU man-up offense. Preview over to Nelson. Stannis Harper. Nelson up top, fake pass, Freeby, Napalili. Napalili over to Cale Nelson, trying to get in there, fake it with the face dodge. Puts a shot wide.
Cale Nelson missed. Ryan Davis sitting wide open on the crease.
He had two defenders from BYU slide over because he was on the crease, and Ryan Davis was sitting there wide open. And there's Ryan Davis again. With a bounce shot.
And a terrific save by Andrus.
5:10 left here in the quarter. A few seconds left here in the penalty. We're going to be in an even situation in about 10 seconds. CSU's had a couple of shots on goal. Napalili over to Davis. Davis with a little face dodge to the right. And that goes off Kubesh's helmet.
And that was nice body position by Brian Kubesh there. Sometimes the smartest thing to do in a man-down situation is just get your body in front of the shot.
Here comes Jeff Jackson in, making an even situation. And Stannis Harper with a nice shot, but Andrus had a beat on it. A nice save.
Andrus had a really nice sequence there. He had about 3 really nice saves.
And that was odd. Mo Poole must have expected something. Kind of ducked. And loses it. It was a nice outlet pass by Andrus. In the window here, you can see this nice shot and a save here by Ryan Andrus.
Watch out for
here comes
a
lob pass
man.
Coming
Watch
over
out.
To CSU on the crease. A very nice opportunity by CSU there, and we're not able to take advantage of it. They had open men on the crease, and there's Ham going off Jeff Jackson's helmet.
CSU has had some really fabulous opportunities. They've had a nice last 3 minutes, with the exception of the fact that they haven't been able to score. Much of that due to Ryan Andrus's play. He's looked really sharp in the last 3 minutes.
A couple of shots going off the heads of BYU defenders, so they're getting in the path of the shot, which is good, but CSU's had the ball down here for about 2.5 minutes. And
the thing you got to worry about when you're a defender and you're getting in the path of the shot is screening the goalie.
If you're going to get in the path, you better make sure you get in the path of the ball.
You got to do it in a way so that the goalie can still see the ball and make the save if it misses you.
Ryan Davis going against the short stick, sees an opportunity, gets it behind. And there's Ham with the shot and a goal. BYU down by 5 goals now. Colorado State leads 11-6.
CSU taking a commanding 5-goal lead. Well, it's going to take some real heart by the Cougars to come out here and respond.
So with 3:59 left, here's the goal by Ham. You can see here just a nice bounce shot. Andrus a little late getting there. BYU in a real hole now, down by 5 goals with 3:59 left in the third quarter. If you're BYU, you've got to make sure that you score at least one more goal this quarter, if not 2, to really get back into this game.
You need a momentum switch here. You don't want to go into the fourth quarter with Colorado State riding high. They need something. They need some great plays on defense. You're right. A couple of goals will really go a long way to soothe that problem.
And I'll tell you that there's some haunting images coming back here. The last couple of games these teams have played against each other, the visiting team has won. So Rand champion's been poking his head in some of the team huddles. Rand, what do you got?
All right, but down here on the BYU sideline, obviously there's a little bit of concern going on, but mainly the thing that's been being preached is just shoot the ball. They're saying that they've been very, very passive in the first half. They're trying to be more aggressive in the second to shoot more and to shoot low. With this wet turf, it's going to bounce more. But the thing that we're preaching most is that this thing isn't over yet. There's still 20 minutes left. So just shoot a lot and shoot low. That's the philosophy down here.
Thanks, Rand. And there are 20 minutes left. And I think we've been talking about it. Alex Smith up high has been phenomenal today. But down low, that's where most of the goals have come from.
Yeah, I'm glad the coaching staff has picked up on that, that their chance for success on shots is going to be a lot better if they put them on the ground. But shoot a lot and shoot low. That sounds like a good philosophy to me.
And you can see there, CSU leading in the shots on goal, 28-13. They're pummeling the BYU goalies, but BYU not putting a lot of opportunities on cage. You're not going to be able to score if you don't shoot. So they've got to be able to get some opportunities here. Good thing for BYU, they've done very well in faceoffs. Let's see if they can win this one here. And CSU looking to come up with it. Mike Spencer still working to come up with it. And Jared Katz for CSU comes up with the ball. CSU winning the faceoff. Another opportunity to score a goal here for CSU. Ball goes down. Taylor Cottrell coming up. Jeff Jackson now winging it down the field. Got a short stick in his hand today. Doing a good job. Gets it up the field here to Mike Lee.
You know, Jeff Jackson was a short stick middie in high school. It's not altogether an unfamiliar position for him. He does look pretty comfortable with that short stick.
So now we've got some new midfield changes coming in. Get that first midfield unit in there for BYU with 3:20 left. We've got an illegal substitution penalty on BYU.
That is absolutely, absolutely not what the Cougars are looking for. They're getting into their settled offense. But these changes of possession due to mental mistakes are really starting to hurt.
They had a great opportunity, BYU did, to get their offensive unit out there, get an opportunity to score, and they gave it away with a substitution penalty. So ball's down now. Nice ride by BYU. Ball is still down. And who's coming up with it here? CSU. Price for CSU, number 33. Lobbing it over there to number 21, Hassan. Hassan rolling down the field here. Gets pushed out by Quiggle. Stanton Harper beats his man, gets it across to Napolili. No, Ryan Davis. Napolili puts it in.
And CSU is on a roll. They just look like they want it more right now. They just seem more into the game, more in sync. The goal differential really reflects that.
That's going to make the score 12-6. And they just move the ball. Stannis Harper gets it across to Napolili. Puts a fake on Anders. Puts it by him.
6-goal deficit with 2:40 left in the third.
You know, Charlie, I still, if it's me, I don't make that goalie change at halftime. I think that's been a factor. And BYU now down 12-6. They've got to get some momentum back there. They've got to get some opportunities back. And CSU now winning some faceoffs when they need them. BYU dominating faceoffs at the beginning of the game, but CSU now winning them when they need them. So there's Preeby now controlling the Farquhar. Gonna have a long stick on him. He's gonna go right. Gonna go right with a nice shot. Anders coming up with a nice save.
Nice save by Anders.
There's Jeff Jackson. He's gonna wheel it down the field. Get it to his attackman. And we'll see some new midfielders come on. Mike Lee now handling it, going against Price. This attack for BYU's got to poke a couple in here.
You know, there's a tendency in a situation like this for individual players to try and take over and carry the team. And it's not the way that this team needs to respond. They need to keep to their game plan, play team offense, team defense. No one person needs to bring the Cougars back. If they're going to come back, they're going to do it as a team.
So the Cougars now had an opportunity to score with 1:32 left in the quarter. They're down by 6 goals. This game is not over by any means, but BYU's got to get a little bit of momentum. Here goes Randall Cohn to the right with a sweep. With a bounce shot, Alex Smith eats it up. Randall Cohn now riding Price. Gets it up to number 19, Phil Eichhorn. And Eichhorn popping it up to number 25. That's John Knobb for CSU, and they clear it, and they call timeout.
And very nearly a slash by Dave Rupert on that play, too.
So CSU, with the possession, takes the timeout. We're going to take a quick break here with 1 minute left in the third quarter. Stay with us.
It's hard to say just why it's so important. But there used to be a time when a family would all sit around a table and say grace. Or when you just find your family talking. Not about anything, just talk. It's hard to say why it's so important. Family, it's where we've always turned. It's where we've always gone. Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints.
Welcome back with 1 minute left in the third quarter. You can see the ground ball battle there being won by BYU, but the score being dominated by CSU.
Colorado State has absolutely exploded in this third quarter. It was 8-6 at the half, and now we're sitting at 12-6, much like the Cougars did in Fort Collins. I just think that the Colorado State team has that loss that really stung for them in Fort Collins in their minds, and just really, really relishing the chance for some revenge here in Provo.
Which you would have thought some of the, and we're going to have a man-up opportunity for BYU. There's 37 seconds left. And push from behind with possession. BYU's got to take advantage of this man-up opportunity. You would have thought that the table was set for BYU here tonight. They didn't have a tough game last night. CSU had a tough game against CU. They're on their home field. You know, they've kind of been on a roll since the Sonoma State game, and CSU has just come out here with more enthusiasm, more energy to take it to the Cougars so far.
And Colorado was 5 minutes away from being in this game tonight. CSU went out a little bit flat against Colorado and had a really tight game. You're right, Marty. This really is a big surprise given the events leading up to this game.
So with 35 seconds left, BYU's in a man-up situation. And we saw CSU come back against Colorado yesterday. Maybe the Cougars can do it here at the end of the third, beginning of the fourth quarters. And there's a sloppy pass, trying to pass it across the crease. Dave Rukert losing the ball. Gets it to Andrus. Andrus trying to clear.
13 seconds, we got to make something happen.
And now here's Jordan Peele bringing it up.
And here you go.
And it's an even situation. Dave Rukert going to the left, unable to get a shot. Takes a left-handed shot, it goes high and wide. And BYU trailing after the third quarter, 12-6. You can take a look here. We're going to take a break. BYU is not out of this game. Stay with us. We're going to be back for the fourth quarter of the RMILL Championships after this.
Because you believe. Programs can be educational as well as entertaining. Because we believe in lifelong learning.
Properly inflating my tires burns less fuel and saves me money on gas.
Yeah, I'm saving Mother Nature from pollution, but more importantly, she saved me $11.
Ow! Environmental events, get green.
By keeping my car regularly tuned, I save money on gas and repairs. That also means cleaner air. You know, feels good to help save the cash planet.
Environmental events, get green. For more tips, go to getgreen.com.
Welcome back to the beginning of the fourth quarter of the Division I RMILL Championship game. The number two seeded CSU Rams are leading the number one seeded BYU Cougars 12-6. And there's plenty of time left in this game, Charlie, but BYU's got to take advantage of some opportunities right away.
BYU missed some opportunities in the first and second quarter, and, you know, missing opportunities in the first half of the game You never want to do it, but there's plenty of game left. Now there isn't. We got 15 minutes left, and BYU is going to have to convert every time that they have a chance to here.
So here's Mike Spencer again. It's Bill McClure out there on the faceoff. And what do we got going here? It's going to go to CSU. We got to push from behind.
And that turns out to be quite a break for the Cougars also, because CSU had a nice fast break set up in that situation.
So CSU handling the ball at this point, up 12-6, and BYU needs the possession. They need as many touches as they can get with that ball, and any time that CSU has the ball right now, it's hurting BYU's chances to get back into this game.
CSU would be very wise right now to just hold on to the ball, just control it. If the Cougars put three goals up on them, it doesn't make any difference. CSU walks away with the win. They just want to control and hold on to the ball now.
And there was a nice shot there by Stanis Harper, backed up by Preeby. So still looking to score, still taking the opportunities.
And Preeby, of course, last year in this game, BYU, I believe, won an overtime victory, a very dramatic win. Took the Rocky Mountain Championships, and then the teams went to St. Louis, and Colorado State swept through the brackets and took the national championship. So,
yeah, this would be the most lopsided, if this score were to hold, this would be the most lopsided win with the game against these two teams in a number of years. Most of the games they played have been very close. There's another shot by Stanis Harper. It goes wide.
Boy, we really are seeing some nice offensive work here by CSU. Very unselfish. They're moving the ball well, and passes are right on the sticks.
Napolilli now going against Kubesh. Cougars have got to press on the defensive side of the ball. Got to make CSU do something with it. There's been talk at the NCAA Division I level of instituting a shot clock, and this is certainly where some time at BYU would like to see a shot clock in place, because CSU can just work that ball around as long as they need to.
Well, things like that have happened in the rules of lacrosse. There was a time, I played during the time when a clearing team could take as long as they wanted to get the ball over the midline. And we would sit sometimes with the ball 2 minutes waiting for the right opportunity to clear it, and you can't do that anymore. So clearly a shot clock, I think that probably would be a pretty good idea.
I know at the Division I level they actually approved it, and then kind of revamped that decision, looked at it again because they weren't. And we've got another illegal substitution penalty by BYU.
So this does not bode well for the Cougars.
Opportunity, like I said, for them on offense.
At the beginning of this quarter, they've got to play flawless lacrosse in the second half. In this fourth quarter.
Let's see here. We've got a situation where the referees are going to review the call. I think the call may have gone the wrong way. Let's see what the referees are going to decide here. The benches seem to be saying that he was calling the penalty on CSU, which would give possession to BYU. And we've got a flag now. So I don't know if that is I don't know if that's another penalty, Charlie. I'm not clear on whether or not they just now had an additional penalty, or if that was a makeup from the last penalty. But regardless, CSU is going to be man down for 30 seconds.
Yeah, but one thing that we know is it is a penalty, and it's an opportunity. It's a goal scoring opportunity, and we also know that with 12:47 left, it's one that the Cougars need to convert.
Absolutely. So we'll see the BYU man-up unit here with 12:47, and I don't think they can take as long as they normally do to get into their man-up offense to get a shot. They've got to move that ball around quickly and just let some shots fly. Here goes Randall Cohn with the shot. No, gets it off to Hardy. Hardy with the move. A nice shot. Unable to convert. Jordan Archibald backs it up. But they've got to get some more shots off, and I think they got to get some more guys shooting other than Rex Hardy.
Yeah, that's true, although I think that shot would have gone in the cage if it were. I think it would have gotten past Alex Smith had it been on the cage.
And there's Jordan Peele on the crease, unable to get that one in.
And a nice hit by the CSU D there. It's good presence of mind to make that hit.
You talked about that last night. If the attackman is on the crease, those defensemen have got to make him think twice about standing there, and CSU certainly did that with Jordan Peele. Here goes CSU. Probably not the wisest of moves. Stannis Harper winging it across the crease. Saw Farquhar on the cut, but nowhere near him, and gives it back to BYU.
You know, if the game were closer, I think we would have seen the Colorado State coaches going crazy on the sideline, but they're able to calm themselves because they have a six-goal cushion right now.
Six-goal cushion with just under 12 minutes left to play. BYU's got to get some shots on Cage.
But CSU missed a great opportunity there, too. Oh, my goodness.
And there is just
that is a confusing pass.
That was a bad pass, and that goes out of bounds. So, again, just uncharacteristic miscues out here today, and that pass was just nowhere near anybody.
And again, failing to take advantage of a possession change right now, right there, a CSU mistake, and unfortunately, Jimmy Young tosses that one with too much elevation across the field. That's called a hospital pass. Your man that goes for that ball has to turn his neck so high to see where that ball is going. He could absolutely get laid out by the opposing team there and put you in the hospital.
So CSU now controlling the possession. Here's Farquhar going against Quiggle.
And now CSU will have the chance.
Quiggle trying to take a stab at that ball.
And a great
Farquhar
shot.
Farquhar gets by him and puts it in.
Terrific shot.
Wow. Farquhar goes through two BYU defenders to get that one past Andrus.
And it looked like Andrus was expecting a high shot. Usually shots go high in that situation, but instead he sends him that off-speed, slower bounced ball that was it was really a terrific shot.
Farquhar has taken some hits from the BYU defenders, but I'll tell you, he's put them right in the cage.
So, certainly the CSU lead looking insurmountable right now, and they are pumped up on the sideline. Coach Nonberg pumped up with his team as they have a seven-goal cushion in the fourth quarter.
And I'll tell you, Coach Nonberg was sandbagging us at the beginning of the game, really kind of giving us the impression he felt he was going to be lucky to get out of here without BYU blowing them out.
This pass is so crisp for CSU right now.
So here comes Davis now controlling for CSU. That's number 38, Lane Sandifer. So CSU getting some players in that haven't gotten a lot of time so far today. Sandifer, first time he's been in.
All of this even more impressive given the fact that arguably their best defenseman, Mike Plonky, missed the trip.
So here's Davis, tries to sneak it in there to Stannis Harper. Ball's down on the ground, Kikimoto. Trying to clear it out. Spencer gets it over to Andrus. And the Cougars now trying to clear. Andrus gets it to Jimmy Young. Jimmy Young gets hit there by Ryan Davis. Kind of a mismatch, but Jimmy Young didn't see him coming.
Like to see a smaller guy with that kind of moxie out there hitting Jimmy Young. Pretty hard to knock Jimmy Young down, too.
Here goes Cale Nelson. Young now picking up Nelson. Napa Lilly. Against Jason Hunt, and CSU is just slowing things down about now. And there's, oh my goodness, look at that feed by Napa Lilly to Ham. BYU defenders just standing there with their heads turned. A nice play there by Napa Lilly.
The wind is out of the BYU sails right now. And I know going away from this game, that's a big concern for Coach Lamb.
For Coach
this
Lamb.
Team plays very well from a situation when they're in the lead. But there seems to be a trend, given this game and the Sonoma State game, that once a team gets a little bit of lead against this Cougar squad, they're really able to open it up. Colorado State has exploded here in the second half. The Cougars have been held scoreless. And Colorado State's put six goals in.
And like you said, the wind is out of the sails, and that just doesn't bode well for the Cougars looking to the national tournament starting in a couple of weeks. So, and we're going to have a few penalties here. We're going to have a few penalties here.
Well, it was a terrific wrap check there. A very, very impressive wrap check. And then I think you're going to get it in sportsmanlike. Was there a flag thrown on the check?
They're calling a hold, I believe, on BYU. And then I believe they're going to call an unsportsmanlike conduct.
I don't think that was a hold, honestly. That was a, well, stick stayed in there a little while.
But
if you see, yeah, you see, it's,
and they're going to call a penalty on the kick of the stick there.
That's number 19, Phil Eichhorn, with a little bit of a heady play holding on to the check.
And they're waving off the penalty. Now this is interesting.
Which penalty are they waving off?
Yeah, because this is interesting because they threw a flag on the unsportsmanlike conduct. So this is interesting.
And it doesn't seem to be a good turn of events for the Cougars at all.
Well, that's interesting. I mean, you know, they called two penalties there, and it looks like they're waving off both of them, which doesn't make sense for either team.
Well, I don't think they got the hold right, and the unsportsmanlike penalty was clear when Colorado State player kicked the stick. So this is, again, one of those situations where I'm really confused.
So some unique situations here in this game. This is just another one, and the referees have been in the middle of it, but I don't think the referees have changed the game at all. It's just there's been some really interesting calls. And there's Napolilli again, on the number 21. That's Hassan. So Napolilli, two nice feeds to the crease here in the last minute, one resulting in a goal, this one resulting in a clear opportunity for BYU. Napolilli's going to come up with a trick on that one. So Napolilli's going to get a penalty on that. It's going to be 1 minute with the trip.
If there is to be a Cougar run, it has to start right now.
So man up for BYU. They're going to be up 1 minute. Now, if you recall, in the Sonoma State game, BYU did make a run in the fourth quarter, only down by a couple of goals with about 3 minutes left, and then Sonoma State closed it out with a couple of goals. So, like you said, if they're going to make a run, it's got to be now.
Yeah, these are the times that really test the character of a team, and I think maybe the BYU team is going to find out a little bit about itself right now. Maybe they're not even sure how they'll respond. And
there's a shot by Rueckert, and they give it to the goalie, Smith. They give it to the goalie, Smith, and I'll tell you, BYU is questioning that goal because Mike Lee was right on the crease, right behind the goal line.
Maybe we had a bad angle, but I saw Mike Lee clearly closest to the ball. Marty, I mean, you raise an important point. I think we're both a little confused at the officiating here, although I'm not sure that good officiating might have changed the outcome of this game. But I think there have been a few very questionable calls.
And I'll tell you, the way this game's going, I don't think CSU is going to shut it down here. I think they're going to look for opportunities to score. It's getting a little, potentially get a little chippy out there. And there's Nelson, again, looking to score. Andrus stuffs him.
There's a great save by Andrus.
And gets it up to Ryan Davis. And Jimmy Young now taking Davis. And they're going to call a penalty on Jimmy Young.
A push from behind without possession.
Jimmy Young didn't like the call.
No, he did not like the call, but the call looked fair to me.
There's Young against Davis. There's
great
a
check.
Nice check. A wrap check. And now we're going to get a slash. So Jimmy Young gets the check. Takes one more swipe at him, gets the slash, and BYU is going to be man down for a minute. So penalties in this game, Charlie, there's been a lot of penalties, and that's not going to make BYU happy.
Well, this game is a tale of two halves, and of course, we Cougars responded nicely to an initial push, and an impressive initial push by Colorado State, 8-6 at the half, but boy, it has been all Colorado State here in the second half.
And for Colorado State at this point, if this were to hold BYU scoreless in a half, I don't know of too many teams that have done that in the last couple of years. And here goes Faulkner. And Mokul coming up there.
And a nice ride by Colorado State.
And Preby picking up the loose ball. Kubish coming out on him. Trying to force him out of bounds. Freed with a nice move. Going to take it back, settle it down, sees a man
great
on the
look,
crease.
Great look.
That was Katz, I believe. Nope, Stance Harper with the shot.
Now, I'm a little amazed here how far out the BYU players are on a man-down situation. I guess it's the end of the game. You got nothing to lose. You're down this far. You got to make something happen. And in that sense, you know, they should be pressuring the ball.
I think that's the situation they're in, is they've just got to get the ball back. So, and the ball on the outside of the case, and it's Harper. Man coming on. Anderson's got to look up and see him. Jeff Jackson across the field. Short stick. BYU has some numbers here on the fast break, but unable to convert. CSU filling in nicely on the fast break defense. So BYU settling it down, but they've got to start moving to the cage. They're down by 8 goals with 6:33 left. And Jordan Archibald getting double teamed there. Still trying to go to the cage. Double team, spins through his man. Alex Smith with a nice kick save.
And it was a gutsy move by Jordan. There's some nice dodges in there. And Alex Smith has just played brilliantly tonight.
Yeah, Alex Smith has been a momentum changer in this game because BYU's had their opportunities and haven't been able to convert because Alex Smith's made saves. And Jeff Jackson just throws away another opportunity for BYU. Tries to cross, get across the crease to Archibald, just doesn't make the pass.
You know, he's done a pretty nice job in the middle of the field with that short stick today. That was an errant pass, but he did a nice job picking off that clear. Going into the tournament, it could be an interesting argument with among the BYU coaching staff whether or not Jeff Jackson should have a short stick or a long one.
If I'm the coaching staff, I'd put him with the short stick and just work him the next 2 weeks.
I like the way he plays with a long pole too.
I did too, but they seem to need a little bit more.
Great pickoff.
A little bit more moxie. The Kubesh, nice save there by the defender. Nice save there by the defender. Oh,
great,
that was Schmidt.
Great outlet pass.
That was Schmidt defending, playing goalie for a minute. There's CSU. Everything going for CSU right now.
And they are excited on
the
sideline.
Excited. All cylinders coming into BYU's home field championship weekend. Having a tough game yesterday against CSU. Really looked like it was stacked against them, but they've come out here and have really just outplayed BYU to this point in the game.
At this point in the game, just reached 5 minutes left in the fourth quarter.
So the ball on the ground.
And Marty, as you pointed out, BYU still scoreless in the second half, which would be a real accomplishment.
And there's Kubesh picking it up for the Cougars, getting it up the field. There's Nielsen. Almost getting pushed out of bounds. Nielsen bringing it up the field. He's got to look to his attackman. Sees Hardy over on the side.
Hardy
bad pass. He's got to stop that one. Hardy was moving. Didn't get the pass to him, so he had to stop. Here goes Hardy. He's going to shoot it. And there's a nice shot. Again, on the ground. Again, on the ground. BYU now closing the gap to 7 goals, but probably a little too late.
But we have 7 goals now, and I think 5 of them by Rex Hardy.
And an assist on the other. So he's been involved in almost every point that BYU has. And, you know, as much as, you know, Rex has really stepped up, the rest of the team has to do their part as well. They can't just ride Rex's back all the way to the championship.
Somehow they've got to feed off of that energy that Rex generates when they're down. Rex, he seems to be able to always keep his head in the game and play smart. And I think that the rest of the Cougar team would be really wise to watch the way that Rex plays and follow his lead in these situations.
You can see here that another procedure penalty on BYU. It's going to CSU. And Jared Katz going against Rupert. And again, they're just going to go to the cage if it's there. And settling it down. 4:14 left in the game. There's Napalili going against Charles Kikimoto. Again, they faced each other in high school. And there's a nice feed and a cut.
Great stop by Andrus.
Nice save by Andrus. So that was a nice play all around offensively, and then the nice save. And again, we've got a late hit coming in. Who's this going to be on? calling that on Jimmy Young.
Jimmy Young is getting close to his 5 penalty limit here.
Here's the ball down. You see somebody come in here, clear it out. Jimmy Young clearing out the pile. And again, they're just going to call that. Whether or not it's, sometimes it's legal, sometimes it's not. But when you clear out that pile like that, a lot of times you're going to get a penalty.
You know, referees see bodies flying and they think, listen, I got to protect the players out there. Their safety is the most important thing. I didn't see whether that was a legal or an illegal hit, but you're right. Even in situations where players will put a legal hit on others, it is just simply a powerful hit. Referees are gonna call that play 9 times out of 10.
So CSU in a man-up situation, looking very patiently, not looking for a shot initially. There's an opportunity. Stannis Harper takes it. Gets blocked there by the BYU defender.
You know, CSU really sending a message to the USLIA right now that they can come into BYU's home field and absolutely dominate them. They are clearly a leading contender to win this championship this year. If they can put together, 5 games in St. Louis like they're playing tonight, they have as good a shot as anybody to walk away with the trophy.
And there's a shot by Stannis Harper, and I'll tell you, CSU is doing some things here that I don't think BYU expected. Stannis Harper's got a couple of goals. I don't think they expected him to be much of a factor. But Farquhar just took a left-handed rocket shot there, which I haven't seen him do in 2 games.
Yeah, Farquhar, boy, he is, boy. Watch out, all of the other teams at the USLA that might be watching this game tonight, preparing to prep both of these teams. You cannot underestimate the skills of Farquhar, number 13 on Colorado State. He's just a terrific player.
I think he was part of the Hobart program for a year and a little disillusioned with the Division I experience and wanted to come out to Colorado State, enjoy the mountains, a little snowboarding, a little biking, and he's going to be a dominant force in the USLIA for the years to come.
He probably made a pretty nice trade. I'm sure that Fort Collins is a much prettier town than where Hobart's in Baltimore.
Actually, no. Hobart in Baltimore? No, Hobart is in...
Couple lacrosse announcers ought to know that.
Hobart's in the Finger Lakes area in upstate New York.
Very, very good.
Yes, it is.
Very,
very Which good. Is actually a very pretty area.
Yes, so that is true.
So let us not give misinformation.
We don't mean to disparage the beautiful Finger Lakes region of upstate New York.
Because it is a very pretty area.
It is gorgeous.
We're getting information that it's on Lake Geneva of the Finger Lakes, 3 lakes in upstate New York. Fantastic area.
That being said, Fort Collins is a pretty terrific place.
That information provided by our stat guru and all-around good guy, Tom Campbell. And here goes Hardy again, sees an opportunity, tries to sneak it in there, unable to get it by. And it's going to go to BYU, so... Alex Smith a little pumped up, trying to get that ball in the out of bounds, but Mike Lee there is going to go back to BYU. But
Alex Smith got over to that sideline in a hurry. He was there to defend the shot and ran through a bunch of guys and almost won possession for Colorado State.
Now, I'll tell you, Charlie, this victory by CSU is really going to muddle things a little bit in the USLA pairings for the national championship. CSU gets an automatic bid as the RMIL champion, and then the top-ranked teams outside of the league champions get bids as well. BYU likely to get a bid, but they would have had a higher seed, being the number 2-ranked team. They probably would have had the best track in the national championship to meet Sonoma State.
Well, CSU is ranked number 5 right now. BYU could certainly fall down to a 5th seed going into the tournament. Of course, 2 years ago, BYU won the tournament as a number 6 seed.
Okay. And they could very come in, they could likely come in at about a 6 seed this year, given the rankings right now. So it's going to be interesting to see over the next week or so how the rankings pair out. And there's another goal by CSU.
Now, depending on what happens in California, CSU could end up with the number 2 seed going into the tournament out of this game. If Santa Barbara defeats the Sonoma, well, depending on what happens in the semifinal.
Hey, there's our crew. We want to make sure this is our last broadcast of the season.
Looking good, guys.
There's our crew in the truck. We want to thank all of them for their efforts. They're here most of the day on broadcast days and out here in the cold. We haven't had any warm nights this year. So want to thank all of them for making this possible. It's great to see lacrosse on a national level being broadcast, and it really couldn't be done without their efforts. And we want to thank them and appreciate all that they've done.
A lot of hats are in fashion there in the truck. And Jason Parker in the truck there with that I just got engaged smile on his face.
And I want to thank him particularly in putting these together, and has done a lot of background work to make these productions possible on the graphics and the stats and the halftime spot. There's our graphics ladies right there. Hi, how you doing?
Nice work on the Chiron.
We appreciate that. And they manage the nice graphics that we see, the lax window, all the features that you see here that bring us the BYU lacrosse games. And, you know, an unfortunate outcome for BYU tonight, but overall, from a lacrosse growth experience standpoint nationwide, to be able to see this league championship game nationwide live on TV, it's great to see this with the USLIA.
Well, the USLIA is a terrific league, and they're about to have their annual party in St. Louis, and it shapes up to be just an incredible tournament. Sonoma State playing great lacrosse right now. CSU really seems to be hitting their stride. And then you got wild card teams at the tournament like Stanford, who's playing really nicely of late. BYU is going to have to really go back to the drawing board after a 16-7 drubbing by Colorado State and find their center. But BYU could go on a streak, and I think after this loss would have to be seen kind of as a dark horse to win. But I can't imagine many teams in St. Louis are going to count the Cougars out when they see them on the other side of the field.
And it's going to be interesting to see which teams get in and which teams don't. With Arizona being highly ranked yet losing to Stanford in the WCLL in the semifinals, see if their ranking can get them in. Auburn with an undefeated season should have a good ranking going into the finals. And it's going to be interesting to see how the rankings and how the seeds pan out for the USLIA.
I think those should come out next week. SCLC could really shake up the tournament brackets if Auburn were to lose. That would give an automatic berth to another team in the SCLC and push out. Auburn obviously is going to the tournament regardless of the outcome of their league tournament. So it's going to be interesting to see how it shakes out. I think Arizona gets in either way. It's a tough loss by Arizona to Stanford, but I think the voters will realize that this is a good Stanford team and a respectable loss, if you could call it that. And I would expect to see Arizona in the tournament brackets in St. Louis.
But you could potentially see four or five WCLL teams in there. You could potentially see three Rocky Mountain leagues in there, depending on how Colorado flushes out with some of the final standings.
No, I don't think so. I, as much as I would love to see Colorado there, because I think they're a great lacrosse team, I just don't think there's going to be room in the tournament field for Colorado to make it in. But you could see a lot of teams from the WCLL. There's no doubt about it, because there's just great depth in that conference.
But you'll likely only see, I believe, from the other conferences, the league champions representing, probably Michigan from the CLL and the SCLC, depending on how Auburn comes out, and probably from the Texas League with the Texas A&M. So it's going to be interesting to see how it flushes out over the next week or so as the seedings come out for the USLIA championships. And BYU certainly will be going. CSU gets an automatic bid as the RMIL champion, but BYU will certainly be going based on their rankings. And like you said, 2 years ago they win the national championship as a sixth seed, and maybe that's where they come in.
You know, as CSU was celebrating out there on the field, they just did something that I think is really great. As they got together for their celebration, it wasn't at the midfield with the offensive players. The entire team spontaneously ran to Alex Smith, the goalie. And I think everybody realizes that a win like this is, it's a lot of cases about the goalie.
We're going to be right back with some final thoughts on